and welcome. My name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, I'd like you to join me in a celebration of a show that has now clocked up a remarkable 40 years on BBC Radio. I refer, of course, to Just a Minute, the comedy panel game that's been my great privilege and sheer delight to preside over as chairman ever since that first broadcast in December 1967. All those years ago, the BBC top brass commissioned just one series. But now, as we approach the 41st year, I think they realise that, finally, we're getting the hang of it.
Sheila Hancock, your turn to begin the subject curry. Oh. Will you tell us something about that hot subject in just a minute, starting now?
The hotter, the better. It does, in fact, make me very ill the next day.
Kenneth Williams, shall
I? Hesitation, I'm afraid.
I agree.
Well, I was going to say something.
She had a mouthful of curry. It's not easy.
I was going to be indelicate, so
yes.
I stopped myself.
Yeah, well, it's in the Bible, so yeah. I wouldn't worry.
There are curry?
No.
Curry.
The way it makes you the day after.
Yeah. Oh, really?
The great wind came upon Jerusalem.
So words of wisdom and
yeah,
humour.
Yeah, that gets me nowhere. I don't get any marks anyway. What's the point? What's the point? I ask myself.
You can ask yourself as often as you like.
Look at that clapping. Your performance is a disgrace. Shut up.
It was the impersonation.
Oh. Is that
what
I look
like? I'm in the lead. Oh.
If that's what I look like, well, one of us is terrible.
And Graham Norton, it's your turn to begin. And the subject here is socks. Could you tell us something about socks, starting now?
Socks is famously the name of Bill Clinton's cat. And I'm reliably informed it's the only pussy in the White House that Hillary doesn't mind Bill stroking.
Colonel Sanders as well. He was another fella who enjoyed counting chickens. The reason for this is because he wasn't actually a military gentleman, no. He would stand all the poultry in front of him and make them call out their numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
How fascinating to hear those clips, stretching over 40 years from Just a Minute. And fascination is something the show certainly seems to exert not only on its listeners, but also on its regular panellists. Let's hear from two of them now, Paul Merton and Graham Norton.
I love doing Just a Minute so much. I travel anywhere in the country to do it, and when I sit there and Nicholas announces the panellists for tonight and I look out to the audience, wherever we are, and I just pinch myself that I'm involved in it. It's an absolute pleasure.
That is a wonderful thing about Just a Minute, that when you go out to these towns and cities and do it, the love there is for the show. And you know, if you landed from another planet, it would be inexplicable that people can follow this game. They know the rules, agree with the decisions Nicholas makes, they disagree. It's proper theatre.
As they say in the legitimate theatre, the show must go on. And this one definitely has gone on for quite a time. But exactly why has Just a Minute lasted so long? How better to find out than to pose that very question as a subject to some of our very distinguished panellists. 44 seconds, you tell us something about why Just a Minute has lasted so long.
The main reason Just a Minute lasts so long is because people keep interrupting. They continually...
Paul.
Hesitation.
Yes, because you interrupted. Right. Why Just a Minute has lasted so long and 37 seconds available, Paul, starting now.
It's extraordinary. I think because the actual way of playing it is capable of infinite variety. It's a bit like a game of draughts. It seems very simple, first of all. The rules aren't many. But because of the personalities that play the game, they each bring...
Clement, for your challenge.
Repetition of game.
Yes, you did repeat the word game before. So, Clement, a correct challenge. You tell us something about why you think Just a Minute has lasted so long. 22 seconds starting now.
I think it just seems long.
Sheila has challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, it was hesitation. But let's be fair to Clement. He paused for comic effect. And Sheila, you get a point for a correct challenge, and you have 19 seconds on why Just a Minute has lasted so long, starting now.
Without a doubt, it's because of the participants, excluding myself, of course, Kenny and Derek and Peter Jones and now the younger generation. It's a wonderful game for letting people...
Clement Freud challenge.
She missed me.
Clement, there's no easy way of saying this.
We heard in that clip the lovely Sheila Hancock say that it's a wonderful game. And the creator of this wonderful game is the sadly missed Ian Messiter. As a schoolboy in the 1930s, Ian was caught talking in class. For punishment, his teacher ordered him to recount the content of the lesson so far without hesitation, repetition, or deviation. Ian failed in the task, but the experience impinged on his memory, and later he saw the potential as the basis for a panel game for BBC Radio. Guests who appear in the show for the first time must feel somewhat like that daunted schoolboy as they prepare to meet the formidable challenge of this game. One such debutante was the irrepressible Kenny Everett, towards whom, quite frankly, we weren't entirely fair. Try to spot just how much flagrant rule-bending takes place during his unforgettable first attempt.
And the subject is marbles. Kenny, will you tell us something of those in 60 seconds, starting now?
Marbles is a game that I last played when I was at St. Bede's Secondary Modern School for aspiring twits. And I always used to wonder, as I got my thumb into the marbleising position, about to flick and ruin all the others in the circle, I used to wonder how the heck they got those little coloured squirrely bits to go through the glass. You know, the And anyway, I used to wonder whether they put them in after with a hypodermic or whether they built the glass around the coloured squirrely and how they got all the colours all to intertwangle with each other, all sort of mangling and tumbling in a gay abandon throughout the glass. That's what I used to wonder. And then I'd flick them and in the middle of the circle they'd go scattering all the other marbles in all various directions from east to west and north and probably south as well. And all the other kids would rush around saying, what a wonderful holly player the old geezer is, because they used to call them hollies as well, you know, and they used to call them other things, but I've forgotten what the other things were that they used to call them, because I was very young at the time, and I'm 34 now, and it's been absolutely ages since I was at school, and so I've forgotten the whole thing. And anyway, it was the coloured squirrelies that caught my eye, really, because I had a great eye for coloured squirrelies, and I think I've done much more than a minute.
Well, I'm afraid we were very wicked. We let Kenny Everett go on talking for 90 seconds on the subject of marbles. During that time, he continued, repeated himself, deviated, and also hesitated.
I didn't lose his marbles.
While Just a Minute may be held in esteem by listeners and performers alike, it's also highly regarded by the team behind the scenes. Former producer Chris Neal tells us what working on the show meant to him.
What I loved about producing Just a Minute was, you're in charge of this brilliant classic comedy show, and also working with some great people. Paul Merton, and when I was doing it, we had Clement Freud and Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones, and I was very proud to be the producer who introduced Linda Smith onto the show. And I remember we did that in Sheffield. And also when I was first on the show as a performer, she sat beside me, and I remember she very sweetly wrote on a pad. She didn't say good luck, but she just said have fun, which I think is always the most important note for any new player of the game. It's all about having fun.
Chris there, speaking of the marvellous Linda Smith, who died far too soon and is sadly missed. Here she is at her very best and having fun.
Linda, a correct challenge, 30 seconds available. Answering back, starting now.
Answering back is something that you're told not to do when you're a child. You'll be asked a question, what do you think you're doing? You try to answer this inquiry and immediately get shouted at. Someone will say, don't answer back. Well, what a ridiculous thing to do. How are you supposed to respond with silence? I suppose that will be called dumb insolence, wouldn't it? You just can't win.
Paul, challenge.
Repetition of you. There were
Yeah. You didn't come in.
It was like a festival of you, wasn't it? Yes. It was like a competition to see how many times I could say the word you. Yeah. Well, and I'm just glad someone's had the guts to stop me.
He let two go, but after that, he couldn't.
No,
resist.
I need boundaries.
Marvellous. Now, Paul Merton again, recalling how he first came to appear on the show and what that also meant to him.
Well, thank you, Nicholas. Yes, I remember it was Ted Taylor who was producing at that time late 80s, and I had a phone call from him. He wanted to know what I would be wearing. He suggested I should wear a suit. He also told me that the language was fairly moderate. I think he thought he was booking Sid Vicious. And just the joy of being associated with a programme that I grew up with was enormous. You know, I did my first recording in 88, 5 years before that, when I was living in a bedsit. I used to record Just a Minute off the radio and keep it on little tapes, and that would be my home entertainment because I didn't have a television. 5 years before I did it, I was listening to it in a bedsit on a little tape recorder, so it was amazing to actually do the show.
Since that first appearance, Paul has become a true master of the game, as is ably demonstrated by this wonderful example of his unparalleled improvisational skills.
Flying saucers. 60 seconds starting now.
Well, a flying saucer landed in my back garden about 19 years ago, and I got on it and went to the planet Venus. And it's true, because I've got photographs here of me standing on the surface of that particular planet. And anybody who says that this is false can come and outside and I'll give them a damn good fight, because I was trapped on that particular orb in space for years. I tried speaking to the Venusians and said, look, it's not my fault I'm here. I was kidnapped by one of your people. They said, it's got nothing to do with us. It could have been anybody they picked up. We had Winston Churchill about 30 years ago. And before that, Sir Stanley Matthews, the Wizard of the Wing, spent a fortnight on this very surface. I thought, well, I'm very proud to be in such august company. And they said, so you should be and all. What do you want for your dinner? I said, well, what have you got? They said, well, we can offer you fish cakes if that's not too fantastic for you. I thought, it's quite an extraordinary concept, the idea of eating that particular meal out here this far away from the Earth where I was originally came from. They said, well, look, do you want it or not? I said, well, it'd be fine. So at that point, they produced a doner kebab, which to all intents and purposes was completely cold. I said, why is this not served up hot? They said, we got it from a shop in Highgate, and it's a long way away to bring it all the way from that particular part of North London to where we're standing now. I said, OK, I go along with that. What have you got to drink? They said, well, we've got Watney's Red Barrel. I said, come on, that is just too fantastic, because nobody outside of the...
Paul was part of the new wave of Just a Minute panellists who took up the baton from the earlier generation, those unforgettable stars Kenneth Williams, Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones. But one member of the old guard is still with us, showing the young uns a thing or two. Sir Clement Raphael Freud took part in the very first episode and has appeared in every series since. Graham Norton pays tribute.
Having Clement there is terrific because he does give you a real sense of how long this programme has been going. Also, he's one of the few players who is quite competitive and makes it still a game, because I think the rest of us would just let it drift off into just rambling and white wine.
Clement, benefit of the doubt, 13 seconds, why I love each and every one of you, starting now.
As for loving each and every one of the people on this panel, let me begin with Nicholas Parsons, go on to Paul Merton, and then explain how very fond of myself I am.
So let's get on with Just a Minute, which is much funnier than 1 minute, please. And we begin the show with Clement Freud. Clement, the subject is answering back. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
Shan't.
So, Clement Freud, would you like to start us off? The subject is why I love Just a Minute, and your time starts now.
I actually prefer I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue.
The lugubrious master at his deadpan best. Now, this next comment from Graham Norton was put in by our producer, and it really makes me blush.
For me, I think what makes Just a Minute truly special is the involvement of Nicholas, because he is unique. There's nothing else like him. And I love his relationship with the people on the panel, because he can take so much. I mean, teasing is a very small word for what happens to him as he tries to chair the show. It really is very close to bullying a lot of the time. But charming he is with it.
And you'll take over the subject of Parbuckles starting now.
Parbuckles is sort of nautical, like a rope which they call a sheet. Or it might even be a knot.
Kenneth Williams has challenged.
Oh, deviation. It is not a knot.
No, but he said it could be.
It can't like be a knot. It is
a rope.
He was giving an example of how this word...
Carbuckle is a rope. It can't be a knot. It's a rope. It's got to go up and down. A knot can't go up and down. What are you talking about? A knot's for tying, you great knit.
But it doesn't matter. It's not...
Time matters to me! Me. What do you mean it doesn't matter? I think it's important that these people here are given an accurate account of these things. Otherwise, they're going out of this place full of misinformation.
But a few weeks...
Is that what you want? A nation of illiterates walking around not knowing, not having any idea all their lives what a parbuckle is? She's dying to know what a real parbuckle is, and I happen to know.
Kenneth, Clement's already told us a real parbuckle is, but give us an example. You've done your little bit. The audience loved it. We'll get back to the contest. It was an incorrect challenge. Clement wasn't deviating from the subject. He keeps it. There are 13 seconds left, starting now.
In a ship's chandler's shop in Leighton Buzzard.
Derek Nemo challenge.
Repetition of ships.
Yes. They did mention the word ships before.
Not ship's chandler's. Ship apostrophe S chandler.
You're quite right, yes, it was ships before on the plural, and this was ship apostrophe, yes. I'm sorry, Clement.
Oh, is it? Oh,
10 seconds on Parbuckles.
Prefect at school, you've always been terrified of Freud, haven't you?
Said
ships.
I twice. Tried to be
ships apostrophe. Load of rubbish. You ought to resign.
Resign.
I would hardly call that teasing. It was much more like haranguing. But if I'm going to be harangued by anyone, I'm glad it's from masters of that particular art. But then you see, they were my contemporaries. They can get away with murder. The younger generation are much gentler.
Nicholas, darling,
yes.
Angel, baby. Mm. I want to know two things. One, my mother is recording this. Two, if you deny me this challenge, I shall devote the rest of my life to hunting you down and killing you. I said that I believed Rhodes was between Turkey and Greece, and that is true. I did believe it. I now no longer do, because you told me it's somewhere else. But that is, I rest my case on that fact. I can say I believe that Cecil Rhodes talked to a bloody zebra, apparently. But I can't say that I believe, in all ignorance, that Rhodes is between
Nicholas,
Turkey and Greece without leaping down my throat.
I never thought you could be so passionate about gaining a point in a game.
It's Steve. Justice.
It's justice.
Another word you probably don't know about, it's called honour. I'll spell it for you.
Your lodestone was a medieval practice.
Paul Merton-Challenge.
Medieval?
It's where you want to pronounce it. Medieval.
Oh, so we can just pronounce the words that we like to pronounce in any way that we can.
I think
the new rule is.
No, there is a perceived pronunciation.
So if I want to say house, I can go Hussey. And that's fine.
Well, up in Edinburgh, they might say Hussey, but you never know. It depends where you are in the country. I mean, and then I think up in Scotland, they say, do say medieval.
What is that accent you're doing?
Well, Peter Jones is speaking as a whistle, won't gain an extra point for doing so. But Stephen Fry, fortunately, is still in the lead. Is that,
no thanks to you, honey.
And I had this audience here as witnesses to the fact that he's now going to hunt me down and try and kill me, so...
I think you could probably get sponsorship if you really...
The remarkable thing is that Nicholas Parsons has never missed a show in 40 years. Who else in whatever branch of life could ever say that? You know, never missed a day. I don't think it would have lasted anywhere near as long without Nicholas.
Kind words from lovely panellists Julian Clary. Now we have the equally silver-tongued Giles Brandreth respectfully doffing his cap before les grandes seigneurs of Just a Minute legend.
It was some 38 years ago that I first encountered Just a Minute, when I found myself on the roof of Broadcasting House with a lineup of extraordinary people led by Kenneth Moore, the actor, and Nicholas Parsons, the matinee idol of the day. At the end of the lineup was myself and Kenneth Williams. I'd never been so close to this extraordinary, iconic figure who was dancing and screaming and saying, "We're on Just a Minute! We're on Just a Minute!" When I first came to the programme, I was in my 20s, and these were senior people in the industry, and they were so friendly. I love them all. The laconic humour of Peter Jones is one of the great joys for me of Just a Minute. I mean, those early days are part and parcel of my adolescence, and so I came to maturity through Just a Minute. Well, that's my psychiatrist says this explains almost everything.
Now, let's enjoy once more the show's original team who pioneered the way in this amazing programme. Here they are in full magisterial flow.
That's the word, as a little brownie. She was an elf, actually, in fact, and there were only three in her six.
Clement Freud, why do you challenge?
Repetition, actually, in fact. It's only 60 seconds. I mean, one ought to be able to manage 60 seconds without actually, in fact. Oh, right. Bad enough, it was sickening words. Listening to the little chair and the little girl and the little cat.
My daughter!
All right, Clement, you have a point. Would you continue talking about the brownies, starting now?
The brownies...
Derek Nimmo.
Hesitation. Takes us a long time to get going.
No, I think he got going just in time. It is still with you, Clement Freud. The brownies starting now.
The brownies...
Derek Nimmo, you challenge.
Well, I was going to say hesitation again, because he's so slow, he's so ponderous and so boring, really. I mean, you know, every time he's like, "The brownies are going..." And take three onions and two turnips. And we all have to do three times as much work in 60 seconds as he does.
Well, Clement still has another point, and also 15 seconds of which to continue talking about the brownies, starting now.
The brownies are the female junior organisation of the Boy Scouts, which was talking about your...
Derek Nimmo.
Can't hear him.
Peter, your turn to begin. The subject is wrong numbers. Will you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
I think I must have a wrong number. Now, this is absolutely true, because five times in the last 2 weeks I've had messages on the answering machine asking for a male stripper. Now, my wife has encouraged me to go and apply for this job. But they haven't made me an offer I can't refuse. In fact, I've not been in conversation with these ladies. All of them were females. But, you see, I've done a lot of things like carry on.
And Stephen Fright.
Sorry, it was a reflex from my thumb. It was so interesting. It seemed a bit hesitant there.
He was definitely hesitant. Yes, he was.
Well, it's rather a delicate subject, you know.
Worry me, Peter, was you thought of all the things you'd done and you dried up.
So would you if you'd done some of the things I've done.
Kenneth,
there are 16 seconds left for you to talk on the subject of advice to a 21-year-old girl starting now.
It has already been set down by one of our greatest writers. Neither a borrower nor a lender be, and this above all, to thine own self.
Bob Monkhouse has challenged.
I've been listening to this show for 13 years, and that's repetition. He always goes on like that.
Bob, he does, but he wasn't repeating the subject on the card, which is repetition, not repeating his style, his phraseology, or his monotony. So, it's an incorrect challenge.
That's lovely, isn't it? Charming, isn't it? Nicky, how you get treated, you see?
I'm proud to have given
him a point. Ending up with your ego around your ankles. No. It's wonderful, isn't it? Supposed to be your friends.
Kenneth.
Charlotte Bronte said, with friends like that, you don't need enemies.
Kenneth. You don't need any encouragement. As people have said of you, you are actually becoming a cult in your own time.
That is true. I am a cult, an enormous cult. People have said that to me. You are a cult. You are. I'm one of the biggest cults around. It's true. It's true. You're quite right. Quite right. It's very percipient of you to say that, yeah. Nick. That is percipient of him, isn't it?
So he's very percipient. Built up your ego again.
That has done that. That's done a trick beautiful, yes.
Yes. And you have half a second to continue on advice to a 21-year-old girl starting now.
And it was followed by the
So there it is. 40 years of Just a Minute. 40 years of warmth, whimsy, wit, and, of course, repartee.
Peter Jones, your turn to begin. The subject is My Pleasure, and there are 60 seconds starting now.
My pleasure is to sit in the huge library of my country estate and look across the lawns, which were beautifully landscaped by Capability Brown, and
over the Tommy Trinder challenge.
That is no way to describe the Wandsworth Road.
And, Jenny, it's back with you to begin. And the subject now, a great subject for you, I'm sure, a bodice ripper. Tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now.
I wish I had the sort of bosom that could rip fabric. Unfortunately, I've got one of those mean, British, measly old woman bosoms.
Charles Judge.
This is truly deviation.
You mean she's well upholstered?
She has got beautiful breasts.
Well, there's only one way to find out.
They're not going to rent fabric, let's face it, Giles.
Started yet, but he'll start, I hope, soon, sometime, on Spanish Dancing, starting now.
Tap, 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 tap.
Clement Freud has challenged you.
What on earth for?
Too many taps! 29 seconds, Achilles' heel, starting now.
My Achilles' heel is that I find Nicholas Parsons intensely sexually attractive. When I look over there at that blazer and that tie, his hair, the glasses, everything about him says, take me. I don't know what it is. I go home at night, I see these visions of this erstwhile chairman coming towards me, the silvery glints in his eyes beckoning.
Stephen Fry, you've challenged.
This is not an Achilles' heel, this is a strength.
It is.
And Bob Monkhouse will begin the next round, and the subject is My Happiest Holiday. Bob, will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
My happiest holiday was spent at a nudist camp because I approve of nudism, except, of course, on flag days. I believe that there is nothing to be ashamed of in the human body or in mine either, for that matter, and so I like naturist colonies where men and women can go to air their differences and where...
Tony, you have the subject, Bobble and Squeak, 25 seconds, starting now.
As a teenager, I had three hamsters. Bobble, Squeak, and Norman.
Clement challenged.
Norma.
Norman, it was a
Norman.
Male.
How can you sex a hamster?
By staying in a lot and not having many friends.
Spontaneous, improvised comedy is the most exciting and exhilarating entertainment. And it's been a privilege and a joy to be associated with such an iconic show for four decades. Here's to the next 40 years. Thank you so much for listening. Welcome to Just a Minute. Thank you. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it's my pleasure to welcome our many listeners throughout the world, but also to welcome to the programme this week four talented, wonderful personalities who are going to play Just a Minute. And they are seated on my right, that extraordinary comedian, a stalwart of the show, very entertaining, it is Paul Merton. And seated beside him, we have the veteran player of the game who always contributes so much, Clement Freud. And seated on my left, we have someone who is a very amusing, entertaining stand-up comedian and also a very good producer-director, that is Chris Neal. And beside him, we have someone who we've been trying to persuade on the show for a long time. It's her first time on Just a Minute. We welcome the lovely, delightful, beautiful comedian and musical comedy star, Josie Lawrence. Please welcome all four of them. As usual, I'm going to ask them to speak on a subject that I give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviation. Beside me sits Trudy Stevens, who's going to help me with the score. She's going to blow whistle when the 60 seconds have elapsed. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the De Montfort Hall here in Leicester. And as you can hear, we have a very enthusiastic Leicestershire audience, ready for the show to start. And we're going to begin with Paul Merton. But before we do, there's just one thing I want to say, and that is, this show is 40 years old now.
And this is the beginning of the 41st year, shall I say. So we thought it'd be rather apt if we began with a subject which is life begins at 40. Paul, can you talk on that subject for 60 seconds, if you can, starting now?
Life begins at 40 is one of those phrases used by 39-year-olds to explain why they haven't got anywhere in their existence. It's something which you often hear people say to each other. You know, once I was 40, I realised I had to change the direction of my life. I suddenly thought to myself, no longer will I work in the civil service. After all, I'm now 40. I shall give up that occupation and find myself a desert island somewhere, maybe in the Outer Hebrides, where I can go and live.
Clement has challenged.
There are no deserts in the Outer Hebrides.
Because are they not?
No. No. There might be deserted islands in the Outer Hebrides, but no deserts.
Does that make a difference?
A big difference.
Oh.
Because one is very hot, and it's not very hot in the Outer Hebrides.
Oh, I'll just make a note of that. Thank you.
So, Clement, you have a correct challenge. You get a point for that, of course, and you take over the subject, and it is life begins at 40, and you begin now.
Charles Forty was very keen on saying that life began there. The pizzas and the pastas, all sorts of foods which you couldn't get at Lowndes Corner House.
Chris has challenged.
Well, he's talking about food rather than life. Talking about pastas and pizzas and things.
But he was talking about 40, and it was Charles 40.
Yeah.
Sorry, I just buzzed then.
You buzzed. Why did you want to buzz?
Well, I think food is life.
There you are. I think your comment deserves a bonus point. But, Chris, what was your challenge?
Well, that food, you're talking about food, and the subject life begins at 40. Now, whether it's 40 or 40.
Chris, I don't know where you're going, dear Bella, but he established he was talking about Charles 40, and he's associated with food, pasta, he was Italian, and so forth. I think he wasn't deviating enough. So he gets a point.
Sorry, Lester.
Not at all. he gets a point because it was an incorrect challenge. He keeps the subject, and there are 19 seconds available. Life begins at 40. Clement, starting now.
This is why people say you should live for 110 years, because the first 20 don't count.
Paul, challenge.
A repetition of score.
Yes, there's too many scores there.
Yes.
It's all right. No. So, Paul, you have a correct challenge. You have life begins at 40. You have 10 seconds still available, and you start now.
I live at number 38, but the people next door...
Chris challenged.
Paul said live before.
Yes, he did talk about living before.
Oh, yes.
Yes. Listen, Chris. So, Chris, you have a correct challenge now. You have 8 seconds available. Life begins at 40, starting now.
Life begins at 40 is something you do not want to hear if you are a fruit fly, for you only have 24 little hours.
In this game, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. On this occasion, it was Chris Neal. And at the end of that round, he has 2 points. Clement has 2. Josie and Paul have 1. And Clement, will you begin the next round? Aha, yes. Big Ben. Tell us something about Big Ben in this game, starting now.
I seem to remember Big Ben was one of the flower pot men. The other was called Little Bill. But pretty well everywhere you go, there would be different Big Bens, like... In London, it might be a church. In Pittsburgh, it is an extremely talented football player who has an almost unpronounceable and certainly unspellable surname. Let me try and give you the nouns and the consonants that make up. Perhaps I won't.
Chris, you're challenged.
Was there a little hesitation?
A little hesitation?
Well, a big hesitation.
Yeah, I agree. You have a challenge. You have a correct challenge. 26 seconds. Tell us something about Big Ben, Chris, starting now.
Big Ben is a stripper I know who lives in Ashby de la Zouche. he's not as much fun.
Oh, Josie's challenge.
Yes, he went, he's not as much
yeah,
fun.
Yeah, I repeated
yes,
he's.
Yes, you did repeat he. Well,
I
listen, Josie.
Yeah.
I know. So, Josie, you've got a correct challenge. You have 21 seconds, and the subject is Big Ben, and you begin now.
As most of us know, Big Ben is actually the bell. And I actually went to... Oh, bugger! I said...
Paul, you challenged.
Before the charming invitation, we had...
Oh, no!
We had two actualies.
I did.
You did two actualies. Yes, but as it's the first time she's
spoken. First time she's played it, yeah.
First time she's played. But it's the first time she's spoken.
First time she's spoken, yeah. Give her the benefit of the doubt. Give her the benefit of the doubt.
We couldn't bear to penalise her for that.
No, no, not at all.
Most embarrassing.
Yes, also.
So,
yeah.
So we won't take any points away. Because
no.
Paul must get a point because it was a correct challenge.
Yes.
You must get a point because we love you. And you have 15 seconds starting now.
I used to go out.
Someone challenge. Paul.
Hesitation, I'm
afraid. Rubbish!
No!
He may be a friend of yours, but I think he's winding you up.
I know he is.
Yes. So you have a point for that.
Oh, do I?
Incorrect challenge, yes. And 14 and a half seconds.
14 and a half?
Yes. Okay. Big Ben starting now. Chris?
Well, that was a hesitation.
That was a hesitation. No, no, that was.
I only turned to the mic. I was...
And no, darling, you have to get going as soon as I say now.
Right.
Chris, yeah. 14 seconds. Big Ben starting now.
Big Ben is the big clock, which is a tap.
Jersey Chan.
You can say big, can't he?
I certainly can.
You can repeat what's on the card and doesn't matter. Doesn't it? Josie, you didn't know.
No, I didn't.
So I won't charge anything on that. Chris, you carry on. 12 seconds. Big Ben starting now.
Big Ben, Big Ben, Big Ben, Big Ben. It's the clock attached to the Houses of Parliament.
Clement charged.
I think that's too many.
Yes. We have established in previous shows, Clement, which you are aware of, that if you go for too many, then you will be penalised.
Would three have been all right?
Three would have been all right, yes. You did about half a dozen. Clement, 6 seconds. Big Ben, starting now.
Actually, Big...
Paul said...
Well, that was a hesitation.
It was a hesitation.
Wasn't it just?
Yes.
Wasn't
yes.
it just? It was, yeah.
And you've been dying to get in on Big Ben, yeah. So you haven't got 4 seconds to tell us something about this subject, starting now.
Having established...
Josie challenge.
Paul's shirt's upsetting me.
So what do you want us to do about it? He can't change. This is radio, we've established. It doesn't really matter. I describe the clothes
because... I like leopard print.
Yes, right. unfortunately, it's an incorrect challenge. So Paul has to actually get a point for that. Mm. Can't give you a point for the... All right, I'll give you a bonus point because they liked it. Because they enjoyed your interruption. Paul, you get a point because you weren't interrupted. 3 seconds. Big Ben starting now.
Big Ben! Big Ben! Big Ben! That's 3 times and we're allowed to do that.
Well, at the end of that round, it's all very, very close. Clement Freud is trailing a little on 3, but Paul, Chris and, surprisingly, Josie, who's never played the game before, are all equal in the lead. Chris, you begin the next round. The subject is occupational therapy. Isn't it? Nothing funny about it. It's quite a serious subject.
It is quite a serious subject, and I do have some things to point out. Thank you.
And you, repetitious.
And you have 60 seconds in which to try and achieve that, starting now.
When my occupation was a clerk in the duty office of the British Broadcasting Corporation, listening to people's complaints and queries, my therapy was not to put the phone to my ear, but to lay it on the floor and read the paper instead. I couldn't bear their moaning on about Top Gear or EastEnders. I remember once a woman rang in and she said, "Where does Kate Adie get her earrings from? How am I supposed to know?" But I thought, well, I can't just say I don't, so I'm going to say Corby. Corby, that's where she gets sorry. But...
It just shows you that if you want to emphasise to get comedy laughs, you often repeat words, in which case he repeated Corby. Clement, you were the first to challenge, and you have 33 seconds to tell us something about occupational therapy, starting now.
I found it was quite difficult getting occupational therapy because my age prevented me, for instance, from doing the pole vault, which would, I know, have been particularly good for me, but too strenuous. I'm unable to run, would not find the right position in which to place the implement for which there is a hole in the ground when you go in for the Olympics, which I was pretty sure I would be selected for.
I think Clement's occupational therapy is playing just a minute. And he demonstrated genderbread. And he went to the whistle, of course, gained an extra point, and he's now equal in the lead with Paul Merton. And Josie, we'd like you to begin the next round. Oh, I don't know whether this is anything personal to you, but the subject we've been given is The Morning After. And you have 60 seconds as usual. Your time starts now.
The Morning After. Now, the morning after usually means something that happened the night before that was either momentous, historic...
Paul, why the challenge?
Well, the morning after doesn't really mean something that happened the night before.
I was going on to explain.
I'm sorry, Paul, I was completely with her. I realised the morning after usually occurs after something momentous the night before. Right. Josie, it was an incorrect challenge. You still have the subject. You have 51 seconds. The morning after, and your time starts now.
I remember...
No. Right, Paul.
I dare challenge Josie on anything, but...
Nothing's ever held you back.
Hesitation. It wasn't a hesitation. Sorry, I've gone deaf then for a moment.
No. I was sitting beside her. There was a noise coming out of her...
Was there?
...of her very attractive mouth.
She's very nervous. It's the first time she's played the game. But it's about articulation, not noises. It's not noises, is it?
It was the beginning of a word, but she hadn't quite articulated it.
What, are we going to wait for her to evolve? What do you mean? Yeah. What are you talking about?
I was saying I.
Yes, she'd said I, and it wasn't... Let's see, I think...
Let's see what happens, yeah.
Let's see... I think, to be fair to Josie, I mean, yeah. First time, you don't sit on her like that.
No, exactly.
Even if you do know her very well. To encourage them first time.
Yeah, exactly. Always encourage them.
Yes,
yeah.
Right. Josie, there are 50 seconds still available. Don't be inhibited by that. I'm still with you completely. The morning after, starting now.
Are you getting me drift,
I didn't
Nicholas?
Hesitate.
Darling, you did hesitate.
I breathed in order to speak.
I know, but...
If I hadn't breathed in, I would have gone blue, for God's sake.
But you didn't actually start. What I always do in this game is I say, and I look at you and I say, the time starts, and you breathe in on that.
Oh.
And the time starts, deep breath, now, and off you go.
God in heaven.
It is a difficult game, isn't it?
Yes.
And I let you have the benefit of the doubt the last time in
Paul
Chance.
Well, I didn't feel I hesitated.
No, I know you didn't feel
it.
I did.
Well, that occasion,
then. Listen to it when it goes down.
Do you know, I've got some brilliant stories about the morning after, and they're all true, and you'll none of them hear them now.
No, I'm quite happy for Josie to have the subject back.
No. You had a correct challenge, Paul. The other time you weren't correct, and that you were being very, very disingenuous, I think. Anyway, so you have a correct challenge there. You can give it back to Josie if you want.
Yes.
All right. Do you want to?
Yeah.
But you get a point for a correct challenge.
Fine.
Right? Mm-hmm. And
right.
Paul wants you to have it back. So you want take the breath on, and the time starts.
Time right. starts.
Right. 49 seconds, and your time starts. Now.
I remember.
Paul, you challenged.
Deviation. She didn't hesitate.
Paul, we give you a bonus point because we enjoyed the interruption. But, Josie, you didn't hesitate, and so you incorrect challenge. You get another point for that, and you've still got the subject, and you have 48 seconds. The morning after, and your time starts now.
It
wasn't me that time.
Did I hesitate?
Now and go.
Big breaths. Yes, and I'm only 16.
And you're a trained singer too, so
yes.
You know how to take your breaths.
It's been said.
You don't need big breaths when you're talking as when you're singing.
I beg your pardon. No, well, go on. Okay, I'll remember. Sorry.
Remember. Nicholas, you so fancy her.
Is it so obvious?
Yes.
Right.
But it's
right.
Lovely to watch.
Right,
but, in a slightly stomach-churning way.
But I'm still very fair to everybody, even
yes.
Those I'm
yeah,
fancy
right.
less. So, Chris, you had a correct challenge. I can't believe it. There's still 47 seconds left on this subject. Chris, it's your chance on the morning after, 47 seconds, starting now.
The morning after, as we have discovered, is mainly about the night before. Not so much the morning after itself, but the time that happened prior to the morning after. The night we drove... Oh, I said night twice.
Clement challenge.
He said the night.
He said the night twice. The morning after is with you, Clement, with 37 seconds, starting now.
The morning after the night before Crew Alexandra won a football match, they sing Once in a Blue Moon. And as I have no great tone, am I unable to carry a tune?
Chris's challenge. Chris, I'm sorry. Chris has challenged you.
No.
I wasn't. No, I have no challenge, Nicholas.
Right, I have no Nicholas. So, as the doyen of the show, you've decided you weren't challenged, Clement. And Chris has bowed to that and said he didn't challenge you. But you weren't interrupted, so you get a point for that.
Yep.
24 seconds, Clement, the morning after, starting now.
When people die, there's a whole lot of morning after. You see people all over the town, not only here, but in Market Harborough and Princess Risborough. And they are mourning.
Josie is challenged.
There was a slight hesitation there.
There was a slight hesitation.
Market
Harborough. Princess and Risborough. There has to be, because
two
people
words.
Think it could be one word. Is that what you meant?
I think Princess Risborough didn't follow quick enough after Market Harborough. And that's why Josie jumped in there. It was a sharp challenge, but I think you have the benefit of the doubt, Josie. Yeah. And you have 12 seconds on the morning. Shh, quiet. Otherwise you'll think... I don't want you to think I'm favouring her. There are 12 seconds on the morning after, starting now.
I recall waking up the morning after a particularly wild evening on the sacrificial slab at Stonehenge.
Paul, challenge.
Sorry, sacrificial slab?
That's right, sacrificial slab at Stonehenge.
OK, continue. Right.
So why did you want elucidation on that?
I just couldn't hear the word.
Oh, right, right.
I thought you said slag.
Yes. I thought so.
Slab.
There's quite a few of them at Stonehenge, isn't there? Slab. They go there for it. They're known for it.
Obviously don't know Stonehenge as well as Josie does. It was an incorrect challenge, Josie.
Was it?
Another point. Oh. And you have 5 seconds still. Now, keep going, because you've only got 5 seconds. On the morning after, and your time starts now.
I was clutching a bottle of Old English cider and was shaken awake by a druid saying, "Oi, what the bloomin' heck?"
So Josie Lawrence was then speaking at the whistle when gained that extra point, and you'll be interested to know that she's actually leapt into the lead. She's one ahead of Paul Merton and one or two ahead of Chris Neal and Clement Freud. Paul, we're back with you to start. Would you take the subject of package holidays and tell us something about that interesting subject in this game, starting now?
Package holidays became quite popular in the 1970s. People would go to Spain or Mallorca, hop on a plane, and there you were, arrive at the airport at the other end. Get off the airport tarmac and walk.
Clement, challenge.
Airport?
There's two airports, airport tarmac and airport.
Don't I say airplane first time?
No. Airports, two airports.
Two airports, you know.
I was listening, I had to, my job.
They've finally defined it for you, have they? He's been trying to find out for years. They won't tell him.
51 seconds, Clement. Package holidays starting now.
When newspaper advertisements carry package holiday details, they use the word all in, meaning the state in which you find yourself at the end of the holiday, rather than anything else. Money is hugely important in a package holiday. Up, down, along, sideways.
Chris challenged.
Sorry, I'm just a little confused. Money is important in a package holiday, up, down, sideways.
Up, down, along, sideways.
Yeah.
Up is important, down is important, sideways is important.
Where do you keep your money?
Well, I don't keep it up, down or sideways.
Why do you walk so oddly in that case?
Well, we've not found the place I keep it.
I don't think we'll go any further, because up creates all kinds of images which we don't want to follow. And you can't keep your money sideways. Anyway, I agree with you.
Thank you.
Chris, I think it was deviation from knowledge as we understand it. 28 seconds, package holidays with you, Chris, starting now.
I think we've been given the subject of package...
Paul, challenge.
Hesitation, sir.
That was a hesitation. Package holidays, Paul, back with you, and 26 seconds starting now.
I've got a packet of cheese at home, and I thought to myself, why should I be the one that goes on holiday? Why not send this particular combustible? And so I did. So I sent it...
A Clement challenge.
Combustible.
Yeah, it's a new word. It's a new word I said quickly, hoping that nobody would notice it.
And Clement's sitting next to you.
Has it not reached Leicester yet?
No. Well, it reached Clement Freud because he's sitting next to you. I agree. A deviation from English as we understand it.
Yeah.
So, Clement, 19 seconds is with you now. Package holidays starting now.
You're never alone on a package holiday. That's really what it's all about. People, others.
Paul, challenge.
There was a hesitation there, yes.
13 seconds, Paul. Package holidays starting now.
Thomas Cook in the 1860s came up with the idea of the package holiday, and soon his fellow citizens flocked to his offices to demand going to see beautiful places abroad. Somebody would say, I want to fly, but of course they didn't say it in those days because the Wright brothers hadn't invented the aeroplane.
At the end of that round, let me tell you the score, because actually we're moving into the final round. Right. As we move into the final round, let me tell you that Paul Merton's out in the lead, 1 point ahead of Josie Lawrence, and about 5 points ahead of Clement Freud and Chris Neave in that order. So it's still anybody's game. Hooray! So the final round. Chris, I think it's about your turn to begin, and the subject now is I cannot tell a lie. That's a good subject. Try and talk on it. 60 seconds, starting now.
I cannot tell a lie. Clement Freud is the best snog I've had in months. He is fantastic. As our beards meet, there's a little tingle in the air and there's a twinkle in his eye. I cannot complain. He may be a few years older than me, but I'm not saying no to that. Also, I cannot tell a lie. Leicester is the most beautiful city I have ever visited. It is absolutely true. I have been to Florence, Rome, Padua, Paris. They're all slightly nicer. But, oh, God.
Well, you won a few friends in Leicester then, Chris. But, Josie, you challenged first.
Hesitation.
What was it? There was a hesitation, yes. You dried up, and you have 33 seconds to take over. I cannot tell a lie, Josie, starting now.
People think, because I'm an actress, that I would find it easy to tell a lie, but I cannot tell a lie. When I do, my eyes start to flicker. I can't look at the person I'm...
Chris challenged.
True, her eyes are flickering. It was lovely to behold, but I think she was telling the truth, so in a way it's deviation.
Oh, that's a load of codswallop.
No, she said her eyes flicker, she cannot tell a lie. She was conveying that she can tell a lie. I mean,
You can tell when I'm telling it.
I know, but the subject, you can take it literally and say, I cannot tell a lie and never tell a lie. Or you can say, as Chris was demonstrating, I cannot tell a lie and tell the whole series of lies. So this subject can be taken either way.
Yes.
And you were taking it the alternative way to Chris, who challenged you. So, Chris, it was an incorrect challenge. Chris, incorrect challenge. Josie still has the subject and another point, of course. And she has 23 seconds still available. I cannot tell a lie, Josie, starting now.
The biggest lie ever told in the world is that which begins with, I love you. What does that mean, I was going to...
Paul challenge.
Hesitation, sadly.
Yes, because
right.
You're going to repeat
right,
it. Right. So,
that's
Paul.
That's tragic. Is that what you feel?
No, I was lying.
Your eyes weren't going.
Paul, you have a correct challenge. You have 14 seconds. I cannot tell a lie, starting now.
I cannot tell a lie. I'm immensely thrilled to be still associated with Just the Minute. I've been doing it now since the late 1980s, and I'm astonished that it's now reached its 40th year. What better way to mark this whole...
Clement, you're challenged.
By doing some other programme.
Clement, we enjoyed your sarcasm.
That wasn't sarcasm.
Though I thought it was...
No, that was genuine. I cannot tell a lie.
You didn't even challenge, you just interrupted. So Paul gets a point because he was interrupted. He has 2 seconds on I cannot tell a lie, starting now.
George Washington once said to his...
So, as I said a little while ago, that was to be the last round, and it was, and I will give you the final score. Chris Neave, who's been very successful in the past, finished up in fourth place, but a very strong, very powerful fourth place. Clement Freud, who has triumphed many times in the past, in an exuberant third place. Josie Lawrence, who's never played the game before, came from absolutely nowhere. In fact, she's got more points in her first show than anybody else has ever achieved. But she was 2 points behind Paul Merton, so we say, Paul, you're the winner this week. It only remains for me to say thank you to these four exuberant players of the game. Paul Merton, Josie Lawrence, Clement Freud, Chris Neal. I thank Trudy Stevens, who's helped me with the score and blown her whistle so magnificently when the 60 seconds elapsed. And we're also indebted to Ian Messiter, who created this lovely game. And we thank Lucia Galani, who is our producer. And we also thank our audience here at the Mumford Hall in Leicester, who've cheered us on our way. And I think they've had a good time. So from our audience and from me, Nicholas Parsons, and the panel, goodbye. Tune in the next time you play Just a Minute. Welcome to Just a Minute. Thank you. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the Minute Waltz fades away, once more it's my pleasure to welcome our many listeners throughout the world, but also to welcome to the programme four talented and exciting players of this game. And they are seated on my right, a very talented comedian, a comedy writer, an all-round good egg, and that is Tony Hawks. And seated beside him, a brilliant writer, a humorous entertainer, afterward and a speaker, and also an actor, and that's Giles Brandreth. And seated on my left, we have, coming all the way down from Glasgow, that lovely stand-up comedian and brilliant comedy writer, Janie Godley. And seated beside her, somebody who lives in Norfolk, so it's great to have someone from this area here, a wonderful cabaret artist, brilliant lyric writer, and this is, of course, Kit Hesketh-Harvey. Please welcome all four of them. Beside me sits Trudy Stevens, who's going to help me keep the score, and she will blow a whistle when the 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I'm going to ask these four to speak at some time on the subject I will give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviation. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the Corn Exchange in that delightful Norfolk town of King's Lynn. So let's begin the show with Tony Hawks. Oh, and what an apt subject to begin with, because this show has just celebrated 40 years. Which is, of course, a Ruby anniversary. So I think Tony should begin with the subject of Ruby anniversary. Tony, you have 60 seconds as usual, and your time starts now.
What a great honour it is to be given this subject, given that today...
Charles challenged.
Repetition of given.
Yes, you were given too much.
Oh, that's
to
extraordinary. I only did about 8 words and I repeated, didn't it?
So, Charles, that's a correct challenge. You get a point for a correct challenge. You take over the subject. There are 56 seconds still available, and it's Ruby anniversary starting now.
It is 40 years since I first met Nicholas Parsons, who was then a matinee idol, a young Adonis. It was at a party organized by Fanny Craddock with Lionel Blair as the entertainment. They were known as Butch Casserole and the One Dance Kid. And Nicholas was there in all his glory.
Tony, you've challenged.
Repetition of Nicholas.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you can't have too much of a good thing. I was enjoying it, Giles. I'd like to give you a bonus point for that, but it was a correct challenge. So within the rules of Just a Minute, Tony, you get a point. You take back the subject. 40 seconds. Ruby anniversary starting now.
Today is the anniversary of myself and Ruby behind the bike sheds outside Goldstone Junior School many years ago. Every year I celebrate this, a wonderful occasion in my life when I learnt some important skills which I won't go into here, although useful it would be to me in filling valuable seconds. Good.
Charles, you're challenged again.
Well, it was just the valuable seconds, which I imagine is what it was.
But you also have a challenge within the rules of Just a Minute.
Well, I think it's deviation to talk about underage sex on Radio 4.
We didn't. He didn't establish it was underage.
Well, either that, he was very stupid still to be at a junior school aged over 16.
Giles, who said anything about sex?
What were you doing behind the bike sheds?
Well, I'll tell you if you give me the subject back.
He was exploring, but not indulging. Right. But, Giles, we did enjoy your interruption, so I think you deserve a bonus point for that. But Tony was interrupted, so he gets a point for that, of course. Keeps the subject. 17 seconds. Ruby anniversary starting now.
Ruby and I read quietly for over a minute. It was an extraordinary occasion, and one I am delighted to share with you all here.
Giles challenge.
A repetition of the word share. Early on he said yes, there were details he wouldn't share with this
That's
audience.
Right, he wanted to share their experience with us.
So, he's really so determined.
Well, listen, you may boo, but those are the rules of Just a Minute. Giles, 8 seconds still. Ruby anniversary starting now.
The Ruby anniversary that I refer to is like the meeting of Lord Alfred Douglas and Oscar Wilde, or Henry Stanley and Dr. Livingstone, or even Andy Pandy and Looby Lou.
And Tony's challenge just before the whistle.
Well, there were three oars in a row.
Normally,
we let three oars in a row.
No, we don't like too many oars on this show. Yes, I'm inclined always to let two go, but three, I think, is repetition.
So you
clever clogs have got in with half a second to go on Ruby anniversary, starting now.
Lulu once said.
In this game, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point, and it was Tony Hawks. So let's go to Kit Hesketh-Arby to begin the next round. Kit, oh, good one to follow, yes. What? Words per minute. Applicable to this show, and certainly applicable to you. You got many words in your lyrics. Would you please talk on that subject, starting now?
In the 1950s, when women knew their place, their skills were judged by their proficiency with cake, box pleating, and words per minute. Thank goodness that situation has now changed. I am afraid my words per minute are not very good. I use two fingers, as I do with many things, measuring whiskey or addressing tax inspectors. But I suppose... The most important thing is that it should be about 30 words per minute. What it is on Just a Minute, I have no idea. I suspect that at the moment I'm not doing very well, but I'm trying to eke it out for as long as I can, because here I am in front of an audience who know me personally and know how many words per minute I'm generally forced to utter.
Yes, Janie, you've challenged.
Just trying to see how long his lungs would go. You must have little wee gills in your back there.
I know.
It did say the word no twice.
There, you spotted it. Well done, Janie.
Yes, no.
There we are. So, Janie, you've got a correct challenge there. And you have 17 seconds. You've got a point, of course. You take over the subject. Words per minute starting now.
I have a baby toddler called Abby who can at least speak 700 words per minute. Children shouldn't be allowed to say that many words in one long sentence. I have listened to my own daughter speak 8 million words since she was born. There is a limit to what mothers have to listen to. At any point...
So Janie Godley was then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so. And she's moved forward into third place behind Giles and Tony and Kit's behind them. And Janie, we'd like you to start the next round. The subject is, it'll all come out in the wash. A good subject, plenty of words, 60 seconds, starting now.
Sometimes you assume a stain will come out in the wash until you put it into the washing machine and you wait patiently. After 40 minutes of a cycle, you drag the offending object out, have a good stare at it and think to yourself, that never really did come out in the wash after all. Bleach isn't a good idea to pour onto jam when you think it'll take it away. The other thing you shouldn't ever assume will come out in the wash is when you hide a secret in your past, like I once did when I killed a rabbit when I was 5. I never thought anybody would suspect it was me until a cousin who was alive at the time, he was a grass. He came up and told everyone the rabbit died because...
Tony Hawk's challenge.
Rabbit genocide. Yeah.
I was calling the police.
I was 5.
I think it's too late. I think they were involved, but they let her off.
Yes, I think it was a repetition of rabbit, isn't it?
Yes, there was a repetition of rabbit. We could have had that rabbiting on for ages if you like. We wouldn't enjoyed it so much. Tony, you've got another point. You've got the subject, and you've got 18 seconds still available. It'll all come out in the wash, starting now.
I like to come out in the wash on a boat. On the estuary, marvellous it is, and I will row all through through the day, and people will shout out, he's come out on the wash, there he is. Perhaps it'll all come out.
Kit challenged.
It was come out in the wash, and he said come out on the wash.
That's right, it'll all come out in the wash, yes. And you were on the wash.
Yes. It was all lies,
very nice.
Anyway.
They enjoyed it very much. And, but the trouble is that it didn't happen to King John, did it? And, there's a few historians in the audience. So, Kit, correct challenge, a point, 5 seconds still available. It'll all come out in the wash starting now.
Hill gay, worm gay, Gayton, Gaywood.
Giles, challenge.
Well, repetition of gay, because of the origin of these names.
Yes, yes.
You're not winning many friends in this audience at the moment, Giles. Yes?
You're saying it's all one word.
Yeah. Oh, yes, they're all one word.
Not only is he telling you, the whole of the audience is telling them.
This is them.
Yes, it does appear you brought your people with you.
Local knowledge gained you that point for an incorrect challenge, and you still have 3 seconds, Kit. It'll all come out in the wash starting now.
The wash is fed by a complicated system of dikes who discharge into it, and I think if you're going to come out, this is a very good point.
So Kit Hesketh-Harvey was speaking as a whistle win, gained that extra point, and it's all pretty even spread out between. There's only one point, actually, that separates all five of them. 5, 4, 3, 2, that's all. And... you work out which has got which points. Giles, your turn to begin. The subject, trial and error. Tell us something about that in this game, starting now.
At his trial in 1895, Oscar Fingal O'Flaherty Wills Wilde made a fatal error. Not when he was cross-examined about the house in which the alleged offences took place and asked whether Cowley Street was a respectable address and replied that it might well be, but perhaps not since it was so near the House of Commons, but when the prosecuting counsel...
Tony, challenge.
Repetition of house.
House. Oh,
yes.
Oh, it's like that, is it?
Giles, mm-hmm. It's always been like that.
I think that's what we all agreed to do when we came out here.
Yes.
So, Tony,
it's correct challenge, 39 seconds available. Trial and error, starting now.
I have always been one who favours trial and error whenever doing anything, which is why I never made it into the bomb disposal department. I tried many occasions, and they always said, no, Tony, not today. I went to a court case to see if there would be an error at a trial, and there have been significant errors in the past. I won't go into them now, because it will possibly be too...
Jenny, you challenged.
Yes, errors. He said errors twice.
He did say errors twice.
Yes, he did.
Error on the card.
Yes.
And it's trial and error.
Yes, and I noticed that.
There's deviation. That's it, Jenny. I know you haven't played the game as often as the others, but my gosh, you listen.
I was writing down all the words at the beginning, all the words he's saying.
Darling, there isn't time in this game to write the words
And then
down.
I realised I've just did a funny drawing of a castle, and that wasn't really what I set out to do.
And you challenged for castle, which would have helped at all.
It was errors.
Errors. Yeah, right. You have 14 seconds for you to tell us something about trial and error starting now.
I was at a trial and there was an error. I once got caught with quite a lot of weapons in my house. You think I'm joking? Read the book. And there I was, and everybody was laughing at me. And when I actually got to court, the big trial was actually happening.
Oh, Giles challenge.
Repetition of actually.
Yes, actually,
I do see actually quite a lot, actually.
Janie, would you mind slowing down? I can't write all these words down.
And you have naughtily or cleverly got in with 1 second to go, Giles. Trial and error, 1 second still available, Giles, starting now.
When you move to Lynn, it's very important to find your house. Oh.
So Giles was speaking then as a whistle went. He's now equal in the lead with Tony Hawkes, and Kit Hesketh-Harvey and Janie Godley are equal in second place just behind them. Tony, we're back with you to start, and the subject is the end of the road. Tell us something about that subject in this game starting now.
Keep right on to the end of the road is a song that I remember hearing in my youth and never want to again, which is why I've stopped. So succinctly and beautifully, and you can almost hear the sound of me not... Oh, what is that?
Giles,
pity.
that he wasn't able to go on singing because he was doing it so beautifully, as he said.
But you said that, therefore you're going to
hesitation.
Do you know, it's very interesting. That's the first hesitation challenge we've had in this show. Normally they come quite quickly. Do you realise that? You couldn't care less, could you? Right. Anyway, hesitation is correct. Challenge, Giles, it's with you. 46 seconds. The end of the road starting now.
During the 1997 general election, I knew that I'd reached the end of the road when my wife put our house up on the market during the campaign itself. There was further humiliation for me because I felt the end of the road was there at the foot of every street. The ghastly things that happened to me. I went to open a doctor's surgery. I was invited to unveil a plaque. I did so and I read the words...
Kit challenge.
He did it on awe, didn't he? And he's had lots of eyes. I mean, I know he's a politician, but really.
I did this and I did that.
What do you think?
What do I think? I think you're right.
Well, he did it for awe, you see. Ordinarily, I'd let it go, but
yes, there were
since he's playing a hard
number
game.
Of eyes. Yes, too many eyes. So we let you get away with two or three, but in four or five, no. Right, Kit Hesketh, are they? A correct challenge, a point.
Thank you.
And 26 seconds, end of the road starting now.
Here we are at the end of the A10, and the end of the road might imply that this was in some way a derelict place. It's not. King's Lynn is the most beautiful town, filled with architectural glory. The Custom House, which Pevsner said is the finest building in England. Queen Street, what need I say? It's a great place to come out.
Tony challenge.
Were there two streets in there?
Yes.
Did I?
Yes, there were.
Yes, I think
I'm
the first
sorry.
Street.
Yeah, the first street, yes.
Listen.
He got carried away.
I'm right with
he
you.
He was
it's
playing
difficult.
To his audience and they were encouraging him.
Yes.
Tony, 10 seconds available. The end of the road starting now.
If life is a journey, which it surely is, then why are we in a hurry to get to the end of the road? Yet you see people rushing every day of their lives. What are they thinking of? They should...
Tony Hawkes was in speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He's now one ahead of Giles Brandreth. Then comes Kit and then Janie in that order. And Kit, it's, I think, back with you to start. The subject now is animal attraction. Kit, 60 seconds starting now.
You look at Nicholas Parsons, suave, debonair, oddly sexless, but what you cannot tell audience is that he's emitting pheromones. There's a scent of man musk coming over towards me, which means that he is very attractive to animals. Back in his hotel, it's like living with Virginia McKenna or Bill Oddie. You think that's white hair. It's a snowy owl that's actually landed on his head. He's got a dick in his blazer pocket, and I think it's an eel going up his trouser leg. I can't be sure. However...
Janie, you've challenged.
He said he's about three times.
Yes, I know. I've been hoisted by my petard now, haven't
I? I liked it. I let it go because the eel bit got exciting.
29 seconds still available, Janie. Animal attraction starting now.
I don't like animals. They frighten me. I once saw a crocodile in a friend's bath. You think I'm kidding? Read the book. And there I was, looking at a big tiger. But zoos are horrible places to keep animals. There is no attraction in animal attraction with zoos. You see an...
Tony challenge.
Repetition of zoos.
By the way, what is the book called?
It's a great wee book. I read it. It's all about a time in Glasgow when she's up there. And I know, because I was up there myself at the same time.
Oh,
and I was
one of
the... I was walking up there. I won. I claimed one.
Jones.
No, I never met Janie till later, but it all came back to me when I read her book. Oh, it's great. I work with a fella, I told her that, you know, it's another big neck, that big angry bastard. You come out here, I'll take
it's
you.
It's me that does this to him. It's me.
He just sets me off. Right. Giles.
Hello.
Back to the English.
This is excellent.
The subject
is... you interrupted?
You were interrupted, had a correct... No, it was Tony,
no,
wasn't
but I'm ready to... We did it simultaneously.
It was a long time ago.
It was 40 years ago that you first began that Glaswegian story. And we've enjoyed the edited highlights over the past four decades.
No, I deliver it in different ways. That was not... I've never said that before in that particular way. And there's no reason why... just shut up. Let's get on with the show. Animal attraction is with you, Tony, and there are 13 seconds available starting now.
I was once attracted to an animal whilst hitching island with a fridge. Read the book. Anyway.
Giles, your challenge.
I programmed myself to buzz when I heard the phrase, read the book.
But yes.
And the wrong person said it. Deviation. We've all read the book. It was a number one bestseller.
I'm never going to say it ever again till I die, I promise.
Don't worry, you plugged your book, yes.
Yes.
Around
Excellent
Ireland with a fridge,
it's a really
right.
Good book.
And
it's,
you've got an incorrect challenge. 8 seconds are still available, Tony. Animal attraction starting now.
Dogs are very attractive creatures, there's no denying. Pets, oh.
Kit challenge.
He found it and said,
yes.
Oh,
we call that hesitation. Yes, so, yes, Kit, you have 3 seconds. You tell us something about animal attraction starting now.
Underneath that table, Nicholas has got an aardvark, a bison, a camel, a dictic.
After the show, Kit, you must tell me something about this association with animals and me, which I don't understand. let me give you the situation. Who was then? Oh, Kit was speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He's moved into third place just ahead of Janie. He's one behind Giles, and he's 2 or 3 behind Tony Hawks, who's in the lead. And Janie, we're back with you. Can you tell us something about fortune tellers? That's the subject. You have 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
I went to see a fortune teller once, and she told me I was going to marry Donny Osmond. Foolishly, I was 14 and believed every word she said, converted to being a Mormon, gave up caffeine and fizzy pop, brushed my teeth really brightly, and headed off to Salt Lake City. Disappointment greeted me when I arrived in the place. Donny Osmond was not available. Why did I say that again?
I know, it's
so
a pity.
So many Osmonds to choose from.
Right. So, Giles, you challenge first.
Repetition.
Yes, of Donny Osmond.
You can't get enough of Donny Osmond, though.
No, no, but in this game, unfortunately, you can't. So, 38 seconds available for you, Giles, on fortune tellers starting now.
I was expecting this subject to crop up because I am blessed with second sight. It is not a squint, it is a gift. But,
did you know that I was going to buzz you?
Janie, because I haven't read the book.
Janie, that challenge definitely deserves a bonus point, but you haven't got a challenge when the rules are just a minute. No. So Giles was interrupted. He gets a point. He has 31 seconds. Fortune tellers starting now.
I went to see the most amazing fortune teller in a wonderful place called the Fairstead Estate. And there I was, and this extraordinary gypsy lady who had moved out from Wisbeach. She wanted to improve herself and thought that she was the lovely lady of Lynn who could take my palm.
Kit challenged.
There'll be lots of ladies in there.
Yes.
A lot of ladies.
No, one.
Yeah, there was a couple.
Ladies and there was a lady.
That's right.
Ah.
Ladies, yes.
Ah.
Oh, yes.
I'm so sorry.
But you'll want to know
I'm
about
so
her.
Sorry. Yes.
I'm glad you were listening to what you were saying.
Yes.
So, Giles, you have an incorrect challenge. You have 15 seconds. Fortune tellers starting now.
Oh, my crystal balls, she said, reaching for her monkey who was on her shoulder, who would come out from the city centre in order to help her take my digits one by one, pull them longer and examine the...
Yes.
Oh, my digits one by one.
That's right. You made a ghastly error.
I did.
And you drew attention to it afterwards, Giles. So,
I did.
But Tony picked you up first. 6 seconds, Tony. Fortune tellers are starting now.
I'm something of a fortune teller, and I can...
Get you challenged.
Bless him, but fortune teller.
Fortune.
No, I'm sorry.
What's
wrong? I didn't know I was going to say that. That's for sure.
A fortune teller.
Mm.
That's rather nice, isn't it? Kit, you've got fortune tellers. 4 seconds are starting now.
The Delphic Oracle used to sit on a tripod and smoke came out from her front bottom bits, which is a neat trick in anybody's book.
So let me give you the scores. We move into that final round. Janie Godley, who hasn't played the show quite as often but always gives great value, is just lingering a little in fourth place. She's a wee bit behind Kit Hesketh-Harvey, who's trailing Giles Brandreth in second place. And out in the lead, 2 points ahead of Giles, is Tony Hawks. Right, Giles, it's with you to start, and the subject now is A Cat in Hell. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
We have started to feed our pet cat a new kind of food, which is called curiosity. And the effect that it is having on the poor creature is dismal. Hell is how she feels at present. We have a menagerie at home, not just our little pussy, who is known as Fido, but also, it's to confuse her, keep her on her toes, but also we have a dog.
Tony challenge.
There was a repetition of also.
There was a repetition of also, yes. And 38 seconds is now available for you, Tony, to tell us something about A Cat in Hell, starting now.
There will be people that say I have not got a cat's hell in chance of complete...
So
I turned into Stanley Unwin.
I know, but it gets a laugh, doesn't it? Right. Kit, you challenge first. A Cat in Hell is with you. 33 seconds starting now.
There is, of course, a cat in Nicola's underpants at the moment, which is suffering all the torments of hell. But hell is also the place in Norway, which is the centre of a jazz festival, accordion-based, and Radio 3 aficionados go there through...
Tony, challenge.
The cat is not featuring enough in this for me.
They're going to be jazz cats who eventually...
Yeah. Oh, yeah,
so,
well,
you see, I'm getting to it very roundabout, but no, enough. Maybe I had deviated.
No, I think you've got a little bit too far away
I
from
think
a cat
I just,
in hell.
Norway is a long
jazz
way.
Jazz festival in yeah. hell, which I'm afraid... Right, deviation, yeah. Tony, back with you. 20 seconds, a cat in hell, starting now.
I have never been to hell, perhaps never will. Who knows, this panel may go there after this show. Such has been their terrible...
Kit Challenge.
We're going to Titchwell, and it's very nice.
Nobody in the listeners, other than the people in Norfolk, know where Titchwell is. Yeah. But it
I
is
urge
true.
Them
I can...
to go. It's beautiful.
Right. No, I've actually been told we're going to have a meal at Titchwell after the show, so if that's what you want to know, save all the letters coming in. So what is your challenge?
Deviation from the truth.
Why?
Because he said we're going to hell.
I don't think technically he was deviating within the rules of just a minute. So, Tony, you have another point. You have 11 seconds starting now.
Were I to be there, perhaps there would be a cat.
A Giles challenge.
A repetition of perhaps.
Yes, perhaps. Yes. Well done, Giles. He did say perhaps before. You've got in with 9 seconds on a cat in hell starting now.
I was advised by a priest when I was young that everybody goes to heaven, it's just that the bad people don't enjoy it. And I'm hoping that when I get to the other place, I will find pussycats galore. A cat in hell.
So let me give you the final situation. Janie Godley, whom we love having on the show and it does so well, but she did finish in fourth place. But Kit Hesketh-Harvey always does well, contributes magnificently. A brilliant third place. Giles Brandreth, who always is great value in the show, in an amazing second place. But he was only 1 point behind Tony Hawk. So wouldn't it be fairer to say that Giles and Tony are our joint winners this week?
Oh, no.
Yes. Remains for me to say thank you to these four delightful players of the game, Tony Hawks, Giles Brandreth, Janie Godley, and Kit Hesketh-Harvey. I also thank Trudy Stevens, who's blown her whistle so well, and also...
Are you taking some sort of betting bung on this, Nicholas?
In what sense?
Well, the person that's 1 point ahead at the end doesn't actually win.
Tony, you got your applause for that extra point that you got. No, I just thought, we are competitive, but at the same time, we're generous. And
yes, but a lot of people are betting on this game around the world now.
Let's have a round of applause for Tony Hawks, because he got 1 point more than Giles, right? Justice is done. So to carry on with the wind-up, I also thank our producer, Tolusha Galani. We're indebted to Ian Messiter, who created this amazing game, and we're very indebted to this lovely audience here at the Corn Exchange in King's Lynn, who've cheered us on our way. And I think they've enjoyed themselves. We have. I hope the listeners have. And they'll tune in again the same time next week when we play Just a Minute! Welcome to Just a Minute. Thank you. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my huge pleasure to welcome our many listeners around the world, but also to welcome to the show four exciting, talented players who are going to show their command of language, their verbal dexterity, their wit, their humour, as they try and speak on a subject that I give them, and they try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviation. And those four are, seated on my right, Phil Jupitus and Clement Freud, and seated on my left, Graham Norton and Giles Brandreth. And would you please welcome all four of them? Thank you. Beside me Sits, Trudy Stevens is going to help me with a score, and she blows the whistle when the 60 seconds have elapsed. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the Courtyard Theatre here in Stratford-on-Avon. And we have people from every quarter of the great county of Warwickshire who've come a long way to be entertained, and they're dying for us to get started. And we're going to begin the show this week with Clement Freud. Clement, oh, what an apt title to begin this show with, being up here where the bard is. Will you tell us something about the Scottish play? Dare he mention the Scottish play? We will find out. 60 seconds starting now.
I'm going to tell the audience something which they probably did know, that Where's the Scottish Play could refer to the prime of Miss Jean Brodie. It actually refers to Macbeth. And the reason why you do not mention the Scottish play is quite simply because in weekly repertory over the years, if any theatrical production did not go at all well, they put on the play which I mentioned a moment ago, which is known as the Scottish play, instead. Therefore, the Scottish play was doomed, death, failure. Something else would go on Tuesday or Wednesday. I think I've told you enough. I mean, this is meant to be...
You not only told us enough, you told us that is actually the reason a lot of people don't know that, why that superstition arose. But Giles, you challenged, you pressed your buzzer.
It was fascinating, it was quite dripping, really interesting, but it culminated with the hesitation.
Yes, that's right. It gave us the facts.
It gave us the facts, and then it faltered. But it was fantastic, it was really impressive.
That's what the radio is about.
Yeah, the mission to explain, it's marvellous.
He decided to return with laurels.
No. I should be going quite soon.
Giles, you have a correct challenge, so you get a point for that. You have 16 seconds still. Tell us something about the Scottish play starting now.
When in the beautiful city of Stratford-upon-Avon we had the Teddy Bear Museum, in our little theatre we put on a
Graham Norton challenge.
Now, don't get me wrong, people. Is this a city?
I'm sorry, a lot of people are campaigning that it should be, and I'm speaking to the future.
So, no.
Graham, the answer is yes, he did deviate, because it's not yet a city. It is a town. Right.
I see. It's
so, Graham, well listened. You've got 11 seconds. You tell us something about the Scottish play starting now.
I was fascinated recently to learn that the Scottish play comes about because in repertory theatres, if a show didn't do well, they would replace it with Macbeth.
Giles challenged.
Repetition, and it was not as well told as the distinguished. The account by Sir Clement Freud was definitive. We didn't need this tired repetition from a man who can't tell a city from a village.
You're obviously niffed, Giles, but he can repeat other people's material if he wants to in this game. There's nothing in the rules that says you can't. So he was not deviating.
I can imagine on
another
this program,
point
that's
for an incorrect challenge. And he has 1 second left on the Scottish play starting now.
Here in the urban sprawl of Stratford.
In this game, whoever is speaking as the whistle goes gains an extra point. And Graham Norton was speaking then when the whistle went, gained that extra point, so he's in the lead ahead of the other three. Giles Brandreth, will you take the next round? The subject is simply the A to Z. And you start now.
The A to Z of Shakespeare characters would include Antony, Beatrice, Cleopatra, Desdemona, Ino, Barbus, Feste, Gertrude, Hamlet, Iago, Jaques, Catherine, Leontes, Malvolio, Nym.
Clement, you challenged.
Didn't he miss out an I?
No, Iago.
He didn't come over to here. Did you hear Iago?
No. I heard Iago.
Yeah,
no.
I heard Iago. Oh, right.
No. Yes. Oh, yeah.
In that case, give him a point.
Clement, you're so magnanimous.
No.
I will definitely give him the point because it was an incorrect challenge.
Yeah.
And you have 46 seconds, Giles, the A to Z, starting now.
Osric, Petruchio, Quince, Romeo.
Graham challenged.
Sorry, what are you talking about?
I couldn't repeat the beginning of it, but I hoped you were listening.
No.
It was the A to Z.
No, I'm sorry, I started afresh. I want to know more. I don't know.
I'll start again.
Okay.
No, he had established earlier on that he was going to give an A to Z of the characters of Shakespeare wrote about.
I'll do something.
Well, then I say it's a deviation.
Why?
Because the subject it's given is the A to Z. This is an A to Z.
The A to Z of Shakespeare characters is this. Well, never mind.
It is an A to Z.
Can I do an A to Z of the city of Stratford? Maybe.
No, but he did start off by saying the A to Z of the characters in Shakespeare. So, Giles, you have the benefit of the doubt, or you just have it anyway. 43 seconds for the A to Z starting now.
The A to Z of the alphabet, of course, is if you do the quick brown fox jumping over the lazy dog, or if you are going to refer to people...
Clement Challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, there was a definite in one of the sentences there, yes. And so, Clement, there are 34 seconds. You take the A to Z starting now.
I believe that the A to Z should never exclude B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, and especially not Y. That's about all I want to tell you.
So, Graham Norton, new challenge.
Yes, I'm here to serve. I was about to stop, so...
Right. 13 seconds, you tell us something about the A to Z starting now.
The A to Z is also a name for a street index of a city. Sadly, Stratford-upon-Avon isn't one, so you probably don't have one.
Giles, new challenge.
Deviation, they do. It's key in our campaign for city status. It's absolutely, it's one of the first things that we're putting forward.
There is not an A to Z for Stratford-upon-Avon, is there?
Yeah.
That man's going, no, there isn't. There isn't, is there?
Listen, we're not in pantomime. Oh, yes, there is. Oh, no, there isn't. And Giles happens to know he's talking about, because he did have a residence up here for a time.
I did?
Yes, you did, indeed. Have you still got it?
No.
Right, well, why did you sell it?
No.
Right, OK, right.
Was it repossessed? What?
It's the campaign headquarters for the Make Stratford-upon-Avon a City.
Oh, OK. So, Giles... If only it was an A to Z, we could find it.
But Giles, you cleverly got in with 1 second to go on the A to Z, starting now.
Wait, the A to Z!
Wait! What is going on? What was
because you challenged him, because he said there was no A to Z for Stratford-on-Avon. No.
There isn't!
There is!
That man said there isn't!
He was the only man in the audience... Yes. Shannon, I'm supporting you. He was the only one in the audience who didn't say any. Everybody else in the audience said there was an A to Z. Giles lived here once and he knows there was an A to Z.
And why do you think that man's wearing lederhosen anyway?
So Giles Brandreth was then speaking when the whistle went, gained that extra point. He's now one ahead of Graham Norton. The other two are following up behind. And Giles, that's your subject. I'm moving on. Phil Jupitus, let's hear from you. Oh, a good one for you, knowing the show you do on television. If music be the food of love...
OK. Keen. I haven't been heard from. I nipped out for a curry.
No, Phil, I always give the now so that if anybody wants to challenge right away... You have a strange effect on some of the audience.
Someone up there's had a booner.
No. If music be the food of love, that is a subject, Phil, starting now.
If music be the food of love, play on a line from one of Shakespeare's splendid works. And it's a fine thing to say, for love needs feeding on a regular basis. It's the kind of emotion that saps the will, that eats away at the nerves and keeps the owner of the emotion in check from day one.
Graham challenged.
I think a repetition of emotion.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry about that, Phil.
That's all right, I can go for afters now.
So there we are. You had a correct challenge, Graham. You kept the subject, and you have 39 seconds. If music be the food of love, start now.
If music be the food of love, I'm guessing it was pretty hungry in the 70s. Yes, David Cassidy, that's not a meal, is it? No, I don't think so. Who else can I talk about?
Phil Jupitus, your challenge.
I think he was hesitating because he began to question whether David Cassidy was a meal. He began to think in the middle of it, well, he's slightly yummy, maybe a snack.
You're right, Phil, the correct challenge, so you have the subject, and you have If Music Be the Food of Love, and there are 25 seconds starting now.
If music be the food of love, then let us feast in these great days of the fine popular artists we enjoy in the charts. Lily Allen provides excellent songs, and they enlighten us to a great degree, and we dance and sing along with her words, lyrics, and melodies as we prance around the discotheques in our dancing pumps. Yes, for we wear special footwear.
I should explain to our listeners that extra spontaneous round of applause was Phil Jupiter's face was an absolute picture as he kept going. It was part of it, but also because Phil hasn't played the game as much as the others, and they recognised his achievement, and he went until the whistle blew, so he gained an extra point. He's still in the failing a little, but he's still there. And
It's a solid four, Nicholas. Come on.
No, it isn't. You're in a solid third place. You're ahead of the oldest player of the play, and that's Clement Freud.
Well, so, now make me feel bad. I'm going to back off now. You've thrown me completely. I didn't realise about this game at all.
Right. You're doing extraordinarily well.
How many tikka masalas playing up on me?
Have you finished?
I'm terribly sorry I have.
No, not at all. We enjoyed it. I encourage people to keep going. Graham, it's your turn to begin. And the subject is an infinite number of monkeys. Can you tell me?
I know what you mean.
Yeah. Well, there's 60 seconds for you to try and go on the subject starting now.
They say if you give an infinite number of monkeys typewriters and lots of paper, they will eventually write a novel. But then so could Jeffrey Archer. So it's not much an achievement, really. I think an infinite number of monkeys is bliss. It just sounds fantastic. It's really hard to get a monkey, apparently. There's laws against it. Though I am told there are certain pet shops in London where if you have enough money, you might be able to get a chimp. I haven't looked into it that much. And also, one isn't the same as an infinite number of monkeys, which are different from that animal, I said. But if you want, that's an ape. I know lots about this. Don't try and stop me. Monkeys. I cheer to the very rafters of this lovely theatre.
Oh, you have been stopped by Clement Freud.
Oh.
What is it? What's the challenge,
Clement? He did repeat monkey, and the word on the card is monkeys.
I know it is.
Well, monkeys to that.
You haven't won any friends.
No,
with
I
that
haven't.
Challenge.
Won. Can I give a few points away?
I wanted him to finish because he went for 50 seconds. So what I do here is because you went almost for the full 60 and the audience loved it, we give you a bonus point as if you had finished on the 60.
What are the chances of me getting that subject ever again?
Never.
The only thing I know anything about.
Well, when you next come back, we'll try and think of another subject about monkeys.
Maybe lots of monkeys.
Yes.
That'd be a nice subject, wouldn't it?
We'll make a note. When you next come back, we'll have a subject about monkeys.
Oh, thanks.
But Clement Freud had a correct challenge, and I must be fair within the rules of just a minute. It's correct. He said monkey, and the subject on the card is monkeys. So you have 10 seconds, Clement. An infinite number of monkeys, starting now.
If an infinite number of monkeys had the vote, there's no good reason why Liberal Democrats should not only get government in the next 10 years, but also reach...
So, Clement Freud was then speaking when the whistle went and gained an extra point for doing so, and he's now in third place, just behind Giles Brandreth and Graham Norton in that order. And he just reminded me, talking about politics and voting, it's the first time in the show we've had two former MPs in our show. We have the former MP for Chester and the former MP Clement Freud from the Isle of Ely.
That's so, total crap. Giles and I have been on this programme together at least a dozen times.
Yeah, I was there too. And I believe Phil was as well. It's funny how it worked out.
What I should have said was it's the first time I have remarked on the fact that we have two former MPs on the show.
Have you left the gas on?
I should explain to
you. Have you taken your pills?
You have to be a good sport to be chairman of Just a Minute. I should explain to our listeners, I set myself up for this deliberately. That's why I've got the job, because they couldn't be as rude as that to anybody else in show business except me. But we enjoy it, we have fun, and...
Deviation, you're not in show business.
If you start coming up with those remarks, I compliment you a moment, I take them away. Right. Clement Freud, it's your turn to begin. Will you take the subject of a Trojan horse, starting now?
A Trojan horse, unlike the Trojan horse, would have come from Troy, which is now in Turkey, which hardly anybody knows. But I happened to be there on holiday, and they said, this is where Trojan horses came from. And I said, really? Are you convinced of this?
Challenge to challenge.
He was hesitating in anticipation of your answer. Yes, he was asking a question.
Yeah, no, asking a question.
Yes, and yes.
Oh. And?
And Giles responded. What are you going to respond to?
This isn't any questions, it's just a minute.
And he responded by challenging you because you hesitated. Yeah, exactly. And it's a correct challenge, so he takes the subject, a Trojan horse, 40 seconds, Giles, starting now.
My name is Helen of Troy, and I am...
She never spoke like
He's
that.
Possessed.
She did. She did. I was about to explain she was a little horse. My name is Helen of Troy, and I'm a little
It's
horse.
Happening again!
What? You're making out that Helen of Troy, one of the most beautiful women who launched 1,000 ships, launched 1,000 ships, and she was a cross-dresser.
Nobody knows what she sounded like because they've lost the tapes.
I know.
She, as you were about to hear, she was a little horse because she was inside the Trojan horse, and the wood, the dust, it was getting up her. Anyway.
You talk absolute rubbish on occasions, Charles. Graham, you had a correct challenge. What was it?
What was it again?
It was correct anyway.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. Oh, yes, you were challenging because you put on that awful voice.
Well, it was frightened, to be frankly.
Yes. I do not believe Helen Troy had a voice like that.
Yes, that's what it was.
Deviation
or something.
38 seconds. A Trojan horse with you, Graham, starting now.
One of my great sadnesses about a Trojan horse is although you could fit a lot of monkeys into it, you couldn't fit an infinite number.
Phil Jupiter's chance.
Repetition of fit.
Oh, yes.
Oh,
good.
Oh, yes. Another point to Phil and 29 seconds available, Phil. A Trojan horse starting now.
The Trojan horse was wheeled into the gates of Troy, and the men within lurked, awaiting the opportunity to spring out and conquer that city, emerging from a gift in a most unsavory way. If on Christmas morning you receive such an enormous timber gift... I'm going to buzz myself in a minute. I'm getting quite tired of it.
Well, you can if you wish. So, Giles, what was your challenge?
He repeated it.
He did. What?
What did I repeat?
What did you repeat?
It was so long ago that I've really forgotten.
Unless you can remember.
The gift.
There.
That's right, yes. All right, 12 seconds, Giles.
Was a Troy a city?
Hmm?
Was?
It didn't have an A to Z, I'm that, I'm sure.
Yes. It would have Alpha had to an Omega. Alpha to...
Oh, clever and funny.
Giles, 12 seconds. A Trojan horse starting now.
The twin-topped towers of Ilium feature in my edition of The Trojan Horse, a delightful children's version of the story written by the late, great Enid Blyton, who gave an account of what happened when...
So, Giles Brandreth, speaking as a whistlewind, gained that extra point, and he's moved forward. He's one ahead of Graham Norton, and he's 3 or 4 ahead of Clement Freud and Phil Jupiter's equal in third place. Giles, it's back with you to start. The subject we'd like you to begin with is juggling act. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
When I was a little boy, I ran away to the circus, but they wouldn't have me. And consequently, I returned home where my mother taught me how to juggle. We began with grapes, moved on to lemons, then oranges, and eventually to melons, which, of course, are really quite difficult to throw in the air with one hand,
catch with the other. I found, of course, this skill very useful when I became a politician. Standing on my head also was something that I had acquired a knack for doing, but it was essentially my juggling act that people appreciated when I was in the House of Commons. Sadly, I wasn't there for long because the people eventually spoke. They got the idea that the way I was spinning the plates on top of these little sticks was not really to their liking. They didn't think much of Clement Freud either. In fact, they wanted to get rid of the whole shower of us. They thought we were like an infinity of monkeys, that's what they said. And if only we'd had a Trojan horse, we could have sneaked into the House of Commons and been there, feeling secure, and then have leapt out and managed to conquer the entire country.
Well, Giles Brandreth started with a subject and finished with a subject. He not only gets a point for speaking as the whistle went, but as he was not interrupted throughout those 60 seconds, he has a bonus point for keeping going. So you've increased your lead at the end of the round, Giles, just ahead of Graham Norton and Phil and Clement in that order. And Phil Jupitus, we're back with you to begin. And the subject we have now is the first record I ever bought. Tell us something about that in this game, starting now.
The first record I ever bought was entitled The Streak by Ray Stevens, and I purchased it for my mother on her birthday, little realising, the great dear that she was, that the gift was actually for me. Yes, I was that much of an evil child that I got something for my mum that was...
A Clement challenge.
I...
Yes. He very cleverly changed from mother to mum.
Well done.
And so he was interrupted. Yeah. Phil, you have a point for being interrupted. You have 38 seconds. The first record I ever bought, starting now.
Oh, yes, they call him the thing that was in the title of the record that I mentioned earlier.
Graham Charles.
I'm an idiot. No, record's in the subject.
Records, yes.
Yeah.
And you can repeat the word.
Yeah, I know.
In the phrase. I know you know it.
Yeah.
You're 33 seconds still available, Phil. The first record I ever bought, starting now.
My female parent wasn't wise to the ruse that I had perpetrated when she unwrapped it in anticipation of it being something that she might actually want. A sound...
It is the most frustrating game. And that applause, by the way, because they love the way you looked as you tried to get it out.
I often get applause of that nature, Nicholas, when I try and get it out.
I'm sitting next to him and he did get it out.
It's what I like to call the member for Southend.
I don't think we should pursue this subject. I think we should get back to playing just a minute. And, Graham, you challenge.
Yes. There was a hesitation.
There was indeed, yes. 20 seconds, the first record I ever bought, Graham, starting now.
The first record I ever bought was by the Monkees. Oh, I was upset to find out there were only four of them, and they looked terribly like men. I still listened to it, though, and pretended that I was surfing on my duvet, which was very rare in Ireland in the 60s. They'd just been invented in France.
So Graham Norton was then speaking as the whistle went, and he's moved forward. He's just one behind Giles Brandreth, and he's three or four ahead of Phil Jupitus and Clement Freud in that order. And that is the situation as we go into the final round.
Oh.
You are a lovely audience. Graham Norton, it's your turn to begin.
Oh, yes.
The subject, very apt for the final subject in the show, the final curtain. Tell us something about the final curtain in just a minute, starting now.
When I go to see a play in the theatre, I love the final curtain because I know it's over. Now, sitting in this place, how on earth are you supposed to realise the hell has reached a conclusion? There is no curtain. The lights go down, yes, but they might come back up again. People could wander on and talk some more. You know, it's... Oh, do you know what really annoys me?
Sorry, it's a challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, but...
Hesitation.
No, he suddenly moved on. He changed direction, but he didn't actually hesitate.
You're the judge.
Yes, I am. And so he has 36 seconds to continue with another point, of course. The final curtain starting now.
The final curtain is also a way of saying somebody's just died. You know, like in the My Way song that Frank Sinatra used to sing before, of course, he faced his own final curtain. It is through tears I now...
Clement, challenge you.
Hesitation. Oh, he was crying.
I know, but he did slightly hesitate. So, Clement, come in on the final curtain with 23 seconds available, starting now.
The first record I ever bought was called The Final Curtain. It was not a terrific success. Few people were in it. The music was poor. The ambiance was pathetic. And it cost 4 shillings and 6p, which at that time was, for a final curtain, a pretty average price, considering it had a hole in the middle.
So let me give you the final situation.
Okay.
As the final curtain comes down,
let me tell you that
Phil Jupitus and Clement Freud both achieved greatness, and they're equal in second place.
Oh!
But slightly more achievement goes to Giles Brandreth and Graham Norton, because together, they're sitting beside each other,
yes,
they finished up together with the same score, so we say they are our joint winners this week. Thank you very much. It only remains for me to say thank you to these four fine players of the game, Phil Jupitus, Clement Freud, Giles Brandreth, and Graham Norton. I thank Trudy Stevens, who's helped me with the score. She's blown her whistle. Also, we thank our producer, Talusha Gilani. We're indebted to Ian Messiter, who created this amazing game, and we're very grateful to this lovely audience here in the Courtyard Theatre in Stratford-on-Avon. So from the audience, from me, Nicholas Parsons, and the panel, goodbye, and tune in the next time we play Just a Minute. Yes!
There'll be more Just a Minute shenanigans with Nicholas Parsons at the same time next week, when he'll be joined by Paul Merton, Clement Freud, Marcus Brigstock and Jenny Eclair.
Welcome to Just a Minute. Thank you. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it's my huge pleasure to welcome our many listeners, not only in this country, but throughout the world, but also to welcome to the programme four exciting, talented and colourful personalities who this week are going to play Just a Minute. And on my right, we welcome back with great pleasure that fine exponent of this game, that lovely comedian, Paul Merton, and sitting beside him is somebody who's played the game more often than anybody else and always gives great value. That is Clement Freud, and seated on my left, we have a lovely comedian and fine broadcaster and writer, Marcus Brigstock. And beside him, we have that lovely comedienne and also writer, Jenny Eclair. Would you please welcome all four of them? And as usual, I'm going to ask them to speak, if they can, on a subject that I will give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviation. Beside me sits Trudy Stevens, who's going to help me with the score, blow a whistle when the 60 seconds are up. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the Playhouse Theatre in that ancient city of Salisbury, and we have a fine Wiltshire audience come from all corners of... corners of the country to cheer us on our way as we start the show with Paul Merton. Who better? Paul, the Druids. Why not? Seeing where we are. Tell us something about the Druids, Paul, in Just a Minute, starting now.
Ah, the Druids. We're close to Stonehenge, and this may be why this subject has come up. As we think of summer solstice day, the little sun pops its head over the horizon, and the Druids, who are an early form of hoodies, gather around, and they watch the golden globe as it traverses across the sky. To be a Druid is a very important thing. It's very difficult to become...
Clement Freud is challenged.
Two fairies.
Yeah. Yes, you had very... Yes, very important, and very... So, Clement, you have a correct challenge. You get a point for that. You take over the subject of the Druids. There are 39 seconds available, starting now.
Anglesey was a very good place for Druids.
Clement, you've challenged yourself.
Why didn't anyone challenge me?
For the simple reason, Clement, that you got in first.
No, I...
And you challenged yourself. So what I'll have to do is to say, Clement, what is your challenge?
I'd like Paul to go on because they... I was really interested.
So what we'll do is give Clement a point for his generosity, and we hand the subject back to Paul and tell him that there are 36 seconds left.
Clement's never liked me. He's never liked me.
I think this is a new form of playing the game.
Yes.
So you get an odd point and then you let everybody else do the work.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, exactly.
So 36 seconds, Paul, on the Druids, starting now.
My father became a Druid in 1958. There was something about the uniform that he found immensely attractive. He was a supporter of Fulham football.
Jenny, a challenge.
His dad wasn't a Druid. He used to work on London Underground. You're not allowed open-toed sandals. But it's health and safety, Paul.
Jenny, I'm sure that you can still work on the underground and be a druid.
Yeah,
part-time druid?
No, you can be a full-time druid, but you don't have to express your religious beliefs on the underground. You just do it in down at Stonehenge.
He always said that the Piccadilly line was a divine mystery. He always said that.
Jenny, what we'll do is I'll give you a bonus point because we enjoyed the interruption, but Paul was interrupted, so he keeps the subject with another point, of course, and he has 28 seconds now on the Druids, starting now.
Extraordinary to have 28 seconds left on the Druids. I have to be very succinct about what I say now, because the panoply...
Marcus challenge.
Is a repetition of very.
Yes,
again.
He said very before. Yeah. Well, listen, Marcus... So, Marcus, you're in on the first round.
Well, no, hang on, because I don't really want the subject either. I'm sort of quite enjoying it coming back to Paul every single time and watching him slowly run out of angles on it.
Exactly. Well,
no, I'll take it. I
think you should. I think we should.
Fine.
We'd like to hear from you. 22 seconds. You've got a point anyway for your challenge. Mm. And you have the Druids starting now.
There are still plenty of Druids around today. You'll find them at the Glastonbury Festival, where they gather to fill their tents with liquid mud and water.
A Jenny challenge.
Slight hesitation.
Yes, enough for me to give it to you, Jenny.
Could I had you speak a flashback to the last time I was at Glastonbury.
Jenny, you had a correct challenge. You take over the subject. The Druids, 12 seconds available, starting now.
Apparently it takes 20 years to learn how to become a Druid. There are so many other hobbies you can have that you can get into.
Paul, challenge.
I don't know if Druids would see their belief as a hobby.
Depends how
hobbies.
Part-time you are. Depends whether you've got a full-time job on the London Underground.
Paul, I'm inclined to agree with you. I mean, the Druids, I mean, the sincere Druids would not see it as a hobby.
No.
But some might be some, as Jenny said, who see it as a hobby. It's their part-time hobby.
Oh, really?
Yes.
The ones who just Druid at the weekend.
So I'm going to give the benefit of the doubt to Jenny on this occasion, and I will try and redress the balance later if I can, and tell her, Jenny, you still have 4 seconds, the Druids, starting now.
Modern Druids are called Neo-Druids, and Marcus is absolutely right. They do tend to gather...
In this game, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point on this occasion. It was Jenny Eclair. Jenny, at the end of that round, you're in the lead, 2-2 to Paul and Clement, and 1 to Marcus and Clement. Will you take the next round? The subject is a poor relation. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
In a metropolitan public house, there was this Englishman, chap from Scotland, someone from Wales, and an Irish Republican supporter. And the reason I am doing this so badly is to explain what a poor relation of a totally hopeless joke sounds like.
Paul has challenged.
You've succeeded. Hesitation.
Hesitation, Paul, correct challenge. You have 36 seconds and you have a poor relation starting now.
Barbara Windsor doesn't see a penny that the Queen gets, and I think that's terrible. She's her own sister.
Marcus, also, you challenge first.
Well, yeah, hesitation.
Yeah, hesitation.
I just wanted to make that point.
Yes.
I didn't want to colour it with humorous remarks.
You got your laugh and you decided to retire on it.
I did, yeah.
That's amazing.
I won't live long on that one, will I?
Marcus, a poor relation is a subject. 30 seconds are available and you start now.
I like cheese. I always have. I'm a big fan of the stuff and I've felt for a long time now that Edam is a poor relation to all of the other delicious dairy spheres that one is able to buy. The ghastly, waxy, beastly thing that it is coming from Holland, I think it does, although it...
Jenny, you challenged.
Oh, well, he just started stuttering and losing his
So we call that hesitation. Yes, indeed, it does come from Holland, but that dried you up. Right.
Are we talking about cheese or poor relations?
You do what you like, darling. The subject is a poor relation, and you have 10 seconds, starting now.
I felt like such a poor relation last time I did just a minute. Paul and Julie and Clary were talking about their country estates. I had to go to the bathroom and have a quiet sulk on the lavatory because I don't have a second home.
So in this game, if you can get in towards the end, it pays dividends because then you're speaking as a whistlewind, which Jenny was doing again, and she's increased her lead at the end of the round. We come to Jenny. To begin, oh, Jenny, I don't know if it's anything close to your heart, but it's just my dentist. Tell us something about my dentist in this game, starting now.
My dentist is a very nice fellow, goes by the name of Philip, up on Denmark Hill in southeast London. I'm meant to go and see him every 3 months, but guess what? Sometimes I cancel. Last engagement, I phoned up, said, listen, I've got appalling flu. He thought I was lying. I'd like to say now on national radio, Philip, if you're listening... I know exactly what I did. I know exactly what I did.
What
I don't want to be told.
You don't want to be told. You have to be told, because I have to hear from Paul.
What repetition of Philip.
Of yes. Philip.
Yes, but he's a very good dentist.
Is he? Right. Well, I think it's too far for me to go to Denmark Hill.
You can send them by post.
You are a wicked so-and-so. You really are.
You'll be doing it Monday.
Right. But to show you how fair I am, as it was such a wonderful reaction you got to your joke, I will give you a bonus point for it. I come here to suffer the slings and arrows of that outrageous fortune that brings me into this hot seat. Paul, a correct challenge. Philip was too much for us all. 41 seconds, my dentist starting now.
My dentist is Simon Godley, who's also an actor, but I haven't seen him for a while, so I've got to give him a ring. So if you're listening to this, can you contact me? Because I can't keep phoning you. I said keep.
Marcus.
He ended up saying keep 4 times.
Yeah. Only 3 of them were wrong.
Yes, that's right.
33 seconds are available, Marcus. My dentist, starting now.
My dentist seems like a reasonable chap, but he's very inclined to encourage me to spend a little bit of time with the hygienist, who is a fearsome bully and a thug. She's a massive woman with huge upper body strength, who spends the entire period of the session driving...
Clement Challenge.
Hesitation.
There was a little hesitation there, yes. I suppose if you judge the pace at which he goes, there was... And it's ironic that Clement should be the one who... But we'll give him the benefit of the doubt on this occasion. So, Clement, 18 seconds, my dentist, starting now.
My dentist lives at 22 Wimpole Street, London.
Marcus challenged.
No, it was the wrong challenge. When you said the number 22, I visualised the two numbers and thought... It was a repetition. Of course, it isn't, because 20 and 2 are quite different words.
That's right, yes.
And also, 22 Wimpole Street is where my gynecologist is.
It's the same guy. All he does is adjust the chair.
Right.
Same guy.
Right, so...
Don't send it by post, though. Right.
They've all got such good laughs, I won't give them all bonus points, but just... in fact, give them all a bonus point. Why not? 12 seconds, Clement. My dentist, starting now.
And he said if I gave his name and address, he would give me an enormous reduction in the price, especially as Jenny Eclair paid less.
Paul challenged.
Tragically, a hesitation there.
Yes, it was a hesitation. And you've cleverly got in with 3 seconds to go on. My dentist, Paul, started...
When you go to China, you have to get a dental appointment at 2:30, because that's 2:30, and that's what they needed.
So, what's the situation? Paul speaks as the whistle went again, got an extra point. He's increased his lead. He's got twice as many points as Jenny, who's in second place, and then Clement Freud and Marcus Brigstock in that order. And, Paul, we're back with you to begin. Oh, a nice intellectual subject. Leonardo da Vinci. Will you tell us something about that character in this game, starting now?
Leonardo da Vinci was a world-known inventor, not only a painter. He invented the helicopter, the hovercraft.
Marcus, challenge.
He didn't really invent the helicopter. He's sort of credited with it, but I think it's deviation, because he didn't actually. It was invented by a Mr. John Helicopter.
Oh, OK.
No, it's very difficult to judge on this because he did do some... he was way ahead of his time in mechanics and statistics and science, and he did invent something which would have been a helicopter. So can you say he invented the helicopter? Yes, probably you did. Benefit of the doubt, I think it goes to Paul. Paul, benefit of the doubt, 54 seconds, still on Leonardo da Vinci, starting now.
And just a minute. That was a magnificent invention of his because as a radio show, it was 400 years ahead of its time. Nobody owned any kind of machine that could pick up this broadcast from the airwaves, so leave people who'd look at Leonardo da Vinci and say, you stick with a painting.
Clement challenged. Why have you challenged, Clement?
Did I challenge?
Yes, you did.
Well, that does surprise me.
That little buzzer in front of you, you pressed it, Clement, and that means you've challenged. Had you nodded off and then suddenly woke up?
I don't blame you.
Do you know, that is exactly what had happened. Right.
You thought you were calling for the nurse. So an incorrect challenge. Paul, we're still with you. 40 seconds on Leonardo da Vinci, starting now.
If you look at his artwork, you can see infinite number of brushstrokes, and that shows you the amount of time and patience he displayed every one of these portraits. Why is the woman smiling in that famous picture of his? Perhaps we don't know. Perhaps she'd heard a room.
Chairman, challenge.
Perhaps.
But two perhapses. Yes. Mm. And Clement, there are 25 seconds. You tell us something about Leonardo da Vinci starting now.
In that 15th and 16th century period, people were known by where they came from, rather like disgusted at Tunbridge Wells. So would Leonardo da Vinci, Vinci being a province of Florence, not particularly well known, hardly sporting a football club in any league whatsoever. And as Paul said, I think very sensibly.
Shelley!
I'm so sorry.
And why are you sorry? He's heard about four times.
Well, yes. I was quite genuinely interested in what he was saying, but it was getting...
I know, but it didn't sound as if Clement was very interested in what he was saying. He did some hesitation. Jenny, you've got him with 1 second to go on Leonardo.
Leonardo da Vinci, Leonardo da Vinci, Leonardo da Vinci.
So Jenny speaking then as the whistle went again, that extra point has moved forward, catching up on Paul Merton, who's still in the lead. And Clement, your turn to begin. The subject is the king's ear. Will you tell us something about the king's ear starting now?
The king's ear has always been considered very important. Otherwise, the crown would have slipped and got right down to... Look at Prince Charles, and I don't think I have to tell you anymore. There is an ideal example of someone whose king's ear is going to serve him extremely well if, when he becomes the next king. Zia. It's also the name of...
Paul, you've challenged.
Well, there was a sort of hesitation in there.
Sort of?
Yeah, sort of.
No doubt.
Yeah, no doubt. No. 35 seconds available, Paul. The king's ear starting now.
It's a rather run-down version of the king's head, a much better pub, but the king's ear at least has a dartboard and a lady behind the bar that knows where the ham sandwiches come from. If you say in the olden days people used to think to themselves, how will we know when the monarch is here and it'd be somebody positioned at the top of the castle to shout, the king's ear? And everybody would know this and they would run down to the bank and start eating Twiglets.
Jenny challenged.
He said no twice. How we know when the king's here?
Yes, you did. Actually. How will we know? And when the king's here, and how will you know? And we do know that you repeated it. So 16 seconds, Jenny, on the king's ear, starting now.
The king's ear has belonged to monarchs, including John, Henry, James, Paul, John. Oh, I don't know my kings.
There was two Johns.
There were two Johns, yes. Yeah. It was a clever idea, but didn't quite come off, Jenny.
One was spelled J-O-N, and the other one was spelled J-O-H-N.
Yes.
One was Scandinavian.
I don't think there's even been a Scandinavian king called J-O-N, John.
It's pronounced Juan.
That. Juan is Spanish, J-U-A-N.
Oh, I'm really confused.
Right. Paul, we're back with you. 9 seconds, the king's ear, starting now.
If you were a confidant of the imperious figure that sits on the throne, you could say to yourself, ah, politically I am safe and sound because I have the king's ear.
Paul Merton speaking as the whistle wind gained that extra point and his increased his lead again ahead of Jenny Eclair, then Clement Freud and then Marcus Brigstock. And Marcus, it's your turn to begin. The subject is Treading the Boards. We're in a delightful theatre here, a wonderful proscenium arch, and treading the boards. It's a wonderful feeling. Takes me back to my youth when I was an actor in repertory. Talk about it, if you can, Marcus, starting now.
Well, I don't know that I can, really, because I wasn't there in your youth on account of the fact that I'm only 34. But if I were to tread the boards in this particular theatre, I would have to more accurately say I were treading the MDF, for that is what we are sitting on with our lovely tables facing this delightful audience in Salisbury. However, it would be very nice indeed to... Don't clap, because I've got a head of steam up now, and you might... Damn it.
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation.
Yes.
What, a head of steam?
No. Talking to the audience.
They started it, in fairness.
They started it, and he's been talking about treading the boards, and you might tread the boards and get a spontaneous round of applause like that, and you might ad lib a reply, which he did. I thought it was completely within the context of what he was talking about. And I've given... And if you doubt it, I have given the benefit of the doubt to everyone now except Marcus. So you got it in spades this time, Marcus.
Thank you very much.
Keep the subject with the point, of course. Treading the boards, 36, starting now.
I should love to play the Dane, not Hamlet, another Dane. Damn. What an idiot.
That's what happened.
What an idiot.
You lost your flow, you interrupted, and you didn't get it back. Right, Jenny, you challenged first.
Two dames. He's very
keen
to be a dame.
The treading the boards, Jenny, and there are 32 seconds starting now.
I have been treading the boards for 25 years. Many different surfaces have I trod, grass, soiled carpet. That's because I've done stinking pubs and fields. I do prefer wood beneath my feet. Sometimes when I go out on stage, I can hear those boards creak and I think, oh no, Eclair, you've done it again, larded up. And then I start running round the boards, not just treading them. I'm charging, cantering, trying to lose a bit of weight as I do my act. You see, there are many things that I'm one of those women.
A challenge came in on the whistle. The whistle gets the benefit of the doubt. So, Jenny, you were speaking. You've got another point for speaking of the whistle. You're creeping up on our leader, Paul Merton, just ahead of you are, Marcus and Clement. And, Jenny, it's time for you to begin again.
I'll take my finger off the buzzer then.
No, you might. Yes, I think you should. Right. Yeah. You ready? Oh, the lovely subject. The Famous Five. I don't know whether you were fans of them, but tell us something about them, Jenny, starting now.
I was far too hardcore to like that kind of nonsense. It was a load of rubbish written by the much maligned English authoress Enid Blyton. I think I can remember their names. Julian, Anne, Dick, Timmy the dog, and George, who was actually a girl, but a tomboy type of ladette back in the 60s. There is some rumour I've heard, interestingly enough, that they're going to bring back the Famous Five as a cartoon on the telly, and the characters are going to be sort of my age now, in their 40s, still solving mysteries and murders, and, you know, it's always diamond heists and jewellery. Kirin Island, remember that place? They went to visit their Uncle Quentin, had lashings of ginger beer. I thought he looked very strange, that relative. I think he... Oh, I said think twice, but... Oh!
What a new challenge.
It's repetition.
A what?
I don't know, I couldn't hear it. She said I said something twice, but I couldn't hear what she said.
I'm not telling you.
No, I'm not asking.
I'll wait. Out of all the words in the world, what do you think I said twice?
Aubergine.
That's right, Paul.
Actually, Paul, I think within the rules of Just a Minute, unless you can tell me what you repeated...
Fair enough.
I can't accept it.
Can I get back to you once it goes out on the radio?
So, Jenny, he didn't know what you repeated.
No, I didn't. I couldn't hear it.
And you have 9 seconds still available on the Famous Five, starting now.
The great thing about the Famous Five is they triggered off gangs all around the neighbourhoods. Do you remember your mate's got...
Paul Challenge.
I don't remember. Nobody formed any gangs around my neighbourhood based on the Famous Five. We saw the difference between fiction and real life.
No, I think it's quite true. The Famous Five were so popular that a lot of people did emulate them, especially youngsters, and form their own little gangs.
Yes,
I think they did, yes, definitely.
It's true.
2 seconds, Jenny, still on the Famous Five, starting now.
We used to cut each other's hands and rub blood.
Oh, Paul challenged again.
Repetition of used.
Yes, you did say used before. So, he's at last got you on the Famous Five. And you've got 1 second, Paul. The Famous Five, starting now.
Michael Parkinson was one of them.
Right. Right, what is the situation? Because we're moving into the final round, actually. Oh, what a lovely audience you are. As we do, Jenny Eclair got a number of points, and she's moved forward. Paul is still in the lead, and he's about six or seven ahead of Jenny. Then Clement Freud and then Marcus Brigshaw. They're sort of equal in third place. Paul, it's... the points aren't so important. It's the contribution, isn't it? And so, Paul, it's your turn to begin, and the subject is audience participation. A bonus point to the audience because they picked it up so quickly. And you can take that bonus point home with the audience. Paul will begin the subject with 60 seconds, of course, starting now.
Here is a marvellous opportunity for audience participation. I say to them now, the audience here, I like Just a Minute Because... Off you go.
All right. There was hardly any verbal. It was all sort of...
just turned into a ranting mob.
And Marcus, you challenged.
Yes, well, there was a pause between...
Yeah, there was. Yeah. Complete hesitation. Yeah. A full stop. Marcus, you have the subject. It's audience participation. 51 seconds, starting now.
I think the last time I had the subject, the audience participated without having been invited and threw me quite off what I was aiming to say. Nonetheless, I'd like to keep relations with the audience as friendly as I possibly can, and if they feel they would like to participate again, I would certainly welcome any assistance that they feel that they can offer, particularly on this subject. I've never been terribly good with hecklers. I did once see a comic dying so badly on stage that a man in the back of the room said there used to be a pool table in here, and I felt terrible for the poor lad as he suffered and drowned in his own self-piteous confusion and bafflement at what exactly had gone wrong with what turned out to be the most...
Clement Challenge.
Repetition of wrong.
Yes.
Yes.
You have wrong. Certainly the audience were disappointed because you obviously got them in the hollow of your hand there, Marcus, but...
I'm not. I was gaining speed and running out of air.
I know. I've noticed that. You actually speed up as you go along.
Yes, which makes it much harder.
Much harder. Much harder. But what a challenge, and you accept it as you go. Clement, 14 seconds are available. You tell us something about audience participation, starting now.
All I can tell you about audience participation is that when I am on Just a Minute, they boo. Quite often, his seldom cheer, and now and again they leave.
They've started booing, you're right.
Yeah.
Wait a minute, Marcus, you challenge first.
Well, yes, deviation, because Clement said they boo, but in fact they went, oh.
So, it's, what are you saying, it's deviation?
Yeah.
No.
I heard quite a bit of
booing. I think benefit of the doubt.
I heard two boos.
I'll tell you what I would do, as you were so obviously playing to the audience, to get audience participation, and there's only half a second to go, and this is the last round, undoubtedly the benefit of the doubt goes to you, Clement, and you have half a second on audience participation starting now.
Half a second.
So let me tell you that Clement's last little flourish brought him into third place, a very good, strong third place, just ahead of Marcus, who was in fourth place. A brilliant fourth place, by the
Thank
way.
Thank you.
I have to say that, yes. And it's the speed in which he goes, which is almost deserves bonus points. Jenny was in second place, a number of points behind Paul Merton. So we say, Paul, this week, you are our winner. It It only remains for me to say thank you to our four intrepid players of the game, Paul Merton, Jenny Eclair, Marcus Brigstock, and Clement Freud. I thank Trudy Stevens, who's helped me with the score, blown her whistle with great aplomb, and we are indebted to Ian Messiter, who created this amazing game. We're grateful to our producer, Tolusha Galani, and we're also very grateful to this lovely audience in the Playhouse Theatre in Salisbury, who've cheered us on our way. From our audience, from me, Nicholas Parsons, and the panel, goodbye, and please tune in the next time we play Just a Minute.
And there are more Just a Minute shenanigans with Nicholas Parsons at the same time next week, when he's joined by Paul Merton, Clement Freud, Lisa Tarbuck and Jack D.
Welcome to Just a Minute. Thank you. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it's my pleasure to welcome our many listeners, not only in this country, but throughout the world, but also to welcome to the programme four exciting and talented players of this game. And on my right, we have that long-term player of the game who's contributed so much over the years, that is Clement Freud. And sitting beside him, we have that wonderful popular comedian who's such an expert at Just a Minute, that is Paul Merton. And seated on my left, we're delighted to welcome back, after quite an absence, that delightful comedy actress and straight actress, Lisa Tarbuck. And beside her, we welcome somebody who's never played the game before. And we're going to give a warm welcome to that wonderful stand-up comedian and actor now, Jack D. Would you please welcome all four of them? As usual, I'm going to ask them to speak on a subject that I will give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviation. Beside me sits Trudy Stevens, who will help me with the score. She'll blow a whistle when the 60 seconds have elapsed. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the Greenwich Theatre in that delightful area of southeast London, Greenwich. So begin the show with Paul Merton. Paul, oh yes, what a good subject to begin with. Killing time. Paul, tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now.
I would not like to be in a position of killing time here in Greenwich, but if we think about the phrase killing time, it's different to passing the time. That indicates a hobby. Killing time means that perhaps you've arranged a meeting with somebody, Victoria Station, 3:30, you look at your watch, they're not there, you get a phone call saying we're going to be 35 minutes before we get there, so what do? In that time, you have to find some...
Sorry.
And who has challenged? Clement.
By mistake.
Yes, Chris.
Was that an accident?
My thumb slipped.
So Paul was interrupted, so he gets a point for that, keeps the subject, and there are 33 seconds left. Killing time starting now.
So you have that rather awkward period when you have to decide what am I going to do to occupy my time until these people that I've arranged to meet up with turn up. And so what do you do?
Clement challenge.
Repetition of up.
Nice.
Yes, up. Oh, yes.
A little bit.
Sounds like there's a storm coming.
Clement, you've got a correct challenge. You've got a point for that. You take over the subject. 28 seconds available. Killing time starting now.
In southeast London, killing time is Tuesday afternoon when the most appalling miseries and villainies go on. I have not ever lived on this side of the river. I've never trusted particularly.
Paul challenged.
A repetition of never.
There's two nevers there.
Yes.
Never, never. You look.
Boo.
Yeah. Is he allowed to lead the booing? Is he allowed? Is Clement allowed to lead the booing?
Yes, he's
allowed.
Got a very nice reaction from the boo, didn't he? But it doesn't get him any points. 12 seconds on killing time, Paul, starting now.
The sad thing is you see some people within the civil service who do nothing but...
Clement challenge.
Repetition of people.
Yes, could you just say people before? You were meeting people and nothing happened. Right. So, Clement, you've got in. It's all happening on my right at the moment. And
it is because you've had a stroke. Be fair. It's unfair. Isn't it?
You're absolutely wicked, aren't you? Yeah. Clement, 8 seconds. Killing time starting now.
Suicide time is rather more interesting, I've always felt, especially in Lewisham. Many people who get on a train at Victoria Station...
Yeah.
In this game, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. On this occasion, it was Clement Freud, and he and Paul have just been playing the game between themselves for the first round. And Clement's in the lead now ahead of Paul. Actually, according to the sort of pecking order, Clement, it's your turn to begin. But I'm sure we'll hear from you, Jack, and
you will.
Lisa
you will.
In a short time. There's plenty of time to go. But Clement, we've got now loitering with intent. That's the subject. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
Loitering with intent lacks a certain immediacy, which you get in killing time. I would very much like either Lisa or Jack to buzz me, because I don't
right,
want
Jack,
to...
you have challenged. He wanted you to challenge him, and you did.
Which is a deviation, because that's not in the rules.
That's it.
I'll ask for that. Yeah.
So Clement's generosity gets him a point, but Jack, you have a correct challenge. I don't know what for, but it's good enough for me. And you take over the subject of loitering with intent, and there are 35 seconds starting now.
Loitering with intent is that activity where you are seen to be hanging around in any given area and people assume that you have a malpractice of fall...
Paul, you challenge.
A sort of hesitation.
Sort of, yes, definite, I think, really. So, Paul, a correct challenge. 26 seconds, another point to you. Loitering with intent, starting now.
The best way to loiter with intent is to intend to loit. And that's what I always do. Find a dark corner of the street, find yourself fined.
Well done, Lisa.
Two fines.
Two fines. Yeah. Well, listen, Lisa, yes. So you've got in with loitering with intent. 13 seconds starting now.
There's a group of kids down my road who, when they all bandy together in their hoodies, look like meerkats wandering around, basically looking for somebody's mum to let them into their flat and allow them to sit.
Jack challenged.
That was a hesitation, wasn't it? Yeah.
I don't know. I'll let you think that.
Jack, actually, I'm the one who decides.
Sorry, Nicholas, it was. I should have asked you. That was a hesitation, wasn't it?
I think in the circumstances, I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt and say it was, but I will redress the balance sometime in Lisa's favour.
I hear that, brother.
Oh, that... That sounded more like a threat.
No, there are no threats here. So, Jack... You have loitering with intent. You've cleverly got him with 3 seconds to go.
Yeah.
And you start now.
Loitering with intent is one of those things that people get up to when they, you know very well...
Paul challenged.
Do we have people before? Repetition of people?
No. I didn't say
you?
It.
No, no. But
it must have been me. It must have been me then.
You said it.
I know I've heard it in the last week.
Yes. I don't think Jack said it.
No, okay.
So, benefit of the doubt, Jack again. And you've got 1 second on loitering with intent, starting now.
Never in my life have I ever...
Well, Jack D was speaking as a whistle went, gained that extra point, and with a little bit of help from the others, he's now actually in the lead. Yeah. The first time player of the game gets all the sympathy, Jack. Play on it.
Right. See, another
Paul
threat.
And Clement are following.
Threat.
Just 2 points behind then Lisa. And Jack, it's your turn to begin. The subject is the eternal optimist. Tell us something about that subject. Starting now.
The eternal optimist is how I would best describe myself. Every single morning, I wake up full of sunshine and good hope for the day, only to have that hope soured and...
Paul challenged.
It was a repetition of hope quite quickly.
A bit too much hope there, I'm afraid.
Can I ask the audience not to go, uh-oh, when... That's unfair. That puts me at a disadvantage and it's slightly humiliating.
Paul, 49 seconds. Tell us something about the eternal optimist starting now.
One of the great giants of silent cinema, Harold Lloyd, portrayed the eternal optimist in his films, and this character chimed in very much with the 1920s, the jazz age, the arrival of skyscrapers, cars for everybody, aeroplanes. It seemed like the modern world was here, and his particular aspects on screen used to bring forward all kinds of joyful enthusiasm. That's not a word, I've made it up. I wonder what it means.
Lisa, you challenged
first. I'd say deviation, actually. Yes.
So, Lisa, you have a correct challenge. 25 seconds available.
Oh,
the eternal optimist starting now.
I know several people who wake out...
Paul. Hesitation.
Yes. So you got it back straight away. Mm. 23 seconds still available, Paul. The Eternal Optimist starting now.
The Eternal Optimist is perhaps not a particularly bad mindset to be in. Always assuming that something nice is about to happen is perhaps better than fearing the worst at all available occasions. I like to think of myself as somebody who is perhaps eternally optimist.
Clement Challenge.
Perhaps.
Perhaps, yes.
Twice. You've
had perhaps before. Well, listen, Clement, a point to you. 9 seconds, Clement, starting now.
Would be someone suffering from Tourette's disease with a speech impediment who wants to be an actor or appear on Just a Minute, alternately some extraordinary...
So, Clement Freud was then speaking as a whistle when gained that extra point. He's moved forward. He's in second place now, one behind Paul. He's one ahead of Jack and a couple ahead of Lisa. That's the sequence. And, Paul, we're back with you to begin. A leap year. Tell us something about a leap year in this game, starting now.
I left the civil service on February the 29th, 1980. I specifically waited for that day to come round so I would never forget it. In fact, this year is also a leap year, so I think that...
Jack challenged.
Sorry, that's a repetition of year, but I'm down. I'm not up with the rules. Are you allowed to say the word again if it's in the title?
Yes, you can repeat the phrase or any of individual words.
In which case, I simply apologise. Sorry, Paul. Carry on.
You don't have to apologise.
Well, I feel I should. I'm polite, aren't I?
It was nice to hear from you.
It's Radio 4.
You didn't know the rules, so we won't charge anything. Paul gets a point for being interrupted. Jack gets a point because we like to hear from him and he hasn't played the game before. Right. And there are 51 seconds, Paul. A leap year starting now.
Apparently, a woman can propose to a man in a leap year. I don't know why we should have to wait for that particular...
Jack challenged.
He went off. It was deviation and hesitation over his words.
Make up your mind, darling boy. What's it? One or the other. Go
all
for
of
hesitation.
It, everything. Hesitation.
Hesitation.
Well
thought you'd never get there. Right. Jack, a correct challenge. A leap year is with you now. 45 seconds starting now.
Is it 45 seconds? I've got to talk about a leap year. I wish I hadn't come in now. Yeah. It's one of the...
Clement, you've challenged.
Hesitation.
That was hesitation, Jack.
Yes, it was. You and can't. You would have hesitated if you'd been asked to talk to about leap years.
I don't have to. I have to adjudicate. Clement, 40 seconds. You tell us something about a leap year starting now.
A leap year is also known as an intercalary year. Oddly enough, nothing to do with calories which you eat, but with a calendar which...
Paul challenged.
Oh, repetition of calendar.
Yes, that's right. Paul, you have 30 seconds.
Do you remember saying it? Calendar. When it goes out on the radio, tune in, you'll hear it. Calendar.
Who are you?
Who am I? I've no idea.
It's age what does it.
Is it?
Yeah.
We're in Greenwich, Clement.
But we're going to let you guess which century.
Paul, 30 seconds, a leap year, starting now.
I wanted to be a hurdling champion, and I thought to myself, I'm going to have to dedicate myself for 12 months.
Lisa, challenge.
To myself.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, it's petty. Come on, it's right.
Well, listen, Lisa.
The first another point I've got, I think.
A big leap for you. 26 seconds are available. A leap year starting now.
People born in a leap year are commonly known as leaplings, apparently. And the whole leap year thing was set up to make sure that the venal equinox and Easter roughly stayed in about the same place so that you didn't have Easter bleeding into...
Paul Challenge.
Easter.
Paul, you...
Repetition of Easter.
Quite right.
If you don't mind, that is.
But I have to tell our audience, I know you warned, you get your sort of personal prejudices going during the show, but those are the rules of the game. So, Paul, a correct challenge, 12 seconds, a leap year, starting now.
And so I would hurdle as long as I...
No, Jack, that's a hideous error. You said hurdler before, didn't you?
That's right, hurdler.
I apologise.
And this was a hurdle, yes, sir.
Dizzy thumb.
9 seconds on with you, Paul. A leap year starting now.
Characterised by the fact it has 366 days in a year, as opposed to the normal year that we're all...
Lisa Challenge, yes.
I've done it again. I did it on the year. I'm just giving you points. I do apologise.
No, don't. It's quite... I'm back eight with
it. I just wanted it.
Clement Challenge.
Repetition of apologise.
Lisa, you challenged your special.
I did.
Best,
nobody likes Nicholas, a smart ass. But yes. I thank you, sir.
Yeah. Jack, you want to say
can
something?
Can I take Lisa's buzzer away from her, please?
Yeah. It's no, on my nerves. She's having a lot of fun.
Three
with
times
it.
Now she's misused it.
Well.
It's a waste of everybody's time.
Reprimanded.
It's a very attractive concept, a beautiful woman with an itchy thumb.
Yeah, well, you just had a bowl bath for her, didn't you? So.
Paul, Alipia is still with you. Half a second only. Oh, that was a bit unfair. Starting now.
Between the end of January and the beginning...
Well, Paul metaphorically did leap forward in that round on Alipia, and he's now in a strong lead ahead of Clement Freud and Jack D in equal place in second, then Lisa. And Clement, it's back with you to begin. The subject now is radioactivity. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
I don't actually know a lot about radioactivity. My activity with radios is confined to switching them on and some short time after that, turning a knob in order to stop the noise emanating from the wireless, which I think is what radioactivity is about.
Poor
there's
challenge.
Not a lot else you can say about it.
It was a hesitation.
Yes, it was a hesitation.
Oh, really? Yes.
38 seconds, Paul. Radioactivity starting now.
There is some activity that's absolutely useless on radio. Let me demonstrate.
I should explain to our listeners that what Paul did then was to get up from his seat and leave the stage. And while he's gone, Jack, you pressed your buzzer, and what was it?
It was deviation.
Deviation and hesitation, yes.
Well, deviation from talking. And that's what this is about.
So, Paul, we give you a bonus point because we enjoyed your particular thought and joke. Jack, you have a point because you got a correct challenge. You have the subject, and you have 33 seconds... 33 seconds starting now.
Radioactivity is one of those things that we must all be very, very scared.
Oh.
Yeah, okay, the gloves are off. What was it this time?
Lisa.
Very, very. Repetition.
Very, very. It's one of the sort of pitfalls for first-time beginners.
Clearly, thanks
very,
for the
very,
warning.
Yes. Well, maybe you'll get it back some way.
I will try.
No.
It's just my confidence has gone now.
Lisa. Correct challenge. 28 seconds. Radioactivity starting now.
I like nothing better than to enjoy one of my hobbies, i.e. jigsawing in the kitchen, with a little light radioactivity going off behind me. Usually I plug into something on a speech-making...
Clement challenge.
Hesitation.
Yeah. Large.
But you're never going to get it out.
No.
Yes, hesitation.
Thank
17
God.
Seconds. Clement. Radioactivity starting now.
I had an uncle who was in radioactivity. This was a very long time ago, and radioactivity then was no way as it is now. For instance, if you switch on a light, you would expect the bulb to transmit a certain amount of light, would you not?
Paul.
It's repetition of light.
Yes, switch on a light,
yes.
A certain amount of light.
Yes.
Don't look so shocked, Clement, it's correct. But Paul got in with only half a second to go.
Yeah.
Radioactivity starting now.
If you've got a Geiger count...
Paul Merton was again speaking of the whistle-weighing game. That extra point has increased his lead. But Clement Freud and Jack D are still equal in second place, not far behind. And comes Lisa, who's going to begin the next round. Lisa, the subject is My Lucky Day. Tell us something about that in this game, starting now.
I had a wonderful day the other day. It was, in fact, my lucky day. I took the dog over to the park because I've got the decorators in at the moment and there's absolutely no peace to be had anywhere in my house, apart from the dust, which is a separate issue entirely. And the day was a rather delightful, sunshiny one, azure blue, scatty clouds coming across, and the silhouettes of the trees making wonderful shapes, which I personally enjoy when nature decides to hand me a palette such as that. I headed towards the gatekeeper's cottage in there, or the bothy, as it's hilariously known, and asked for some doggy poo bags.
Jack, challenge.
Repetition of dog?
Nope.
No.
Oh, no, doggy. It was dog and doggy.
Doggy and dog.
Dog and doggy.
Sorry, Lisa, I apologise.
Yeah.
overestimated the...
Do you want to go and stand over there?
Depends
An
what
incorrect
for, really.
Challenge, I'm afraid, Jack.
Been a very
So Lisa has
boy.
Another point. 24 seconds, my lucky day, starting now.
So I get handed these things, and as the guy has given them over to me, he says, because there's a fair amount that won't fit into my pocket, to be fair, he's...
Jack challenged.
Repetition of fair, and there's no Y on the end of either of those, so...
Yeah. 20 seconds.
Probably very few.
Well, listen, Jack, 15 seconds. It's my lucky day, starting... Now.
My...
Lisa,
hesitation before he came in.
Yeah. Lisa.
Just not his lucky day, is it?
Right, a bonus point to Lisa because we enjoyed the interruption, but Jack gets a point because he was interrupted. He
yes.
has my lucky day and 14 seconds starting
Can I just
now.
Say before it does start that I might actually have to take a breath before I talk, and that's fairly reasonable, I think, on anyone's day, regardless whether it's lucky or not. My lucky day was on last Wednesday when... You wouldn't believe it, but the ice cream man came and stopped outside my house. And what was lucky about it is I happened to have £5 in my pocket. He was ringing his bell. I went outside and said, oh, I'd like a 99, please. And he said...
No, I was just confused. I saw 99 as a visual thing, and I thought it was a repetition of...
No, no.
But it's not.
No.
I was going to say repetition, but of course it's 92 different words.
It's
not
forward.
Really a visual media.
No.
It's metacognition.
Oh, it can be explored. It can be explored.
It can be explored. But Paul was an incorrect challenge, so 99, his visual image, has meant that you have got another point, Jack.
Really?
Incorrect challenge. And you now have only half a second. On my lucky day, starting now.
Well, it so happened that the vendor of...
So Jack Dean was then speaking as the whistle went and gained that extra point. He's doing very well, actually, for a first-time player of the game. We've got somebody way out in the lead there, that's Paul, but Jack's only 5 points behind him. And then Zalisa and then Clement together in the third place. And Jack, we come back to you to begin. The local post office, a very contentious issue at the moment, but talk about that subject, 60 seconds, starting now.
The local post office is one of the best places you can go if you are a trainee armed robber, because they very rarely manage to call the police before you pull the gun out on them. At the local post office, you can buy all kinds of things. I go there for my stamps and usually find that the man behind the counter pulls down his blind just as I approach. You can buy sweets there as well, and newspapers, and if you're very lucky, you live in one of those areas where some kind person will come and put the paper on your doorstep in the morning.
Clement challenge.
Repetition of paper.
Paper.
No, well, newspaper.
Newspaper and then paper.
Yeah,
that's
news,
right.
Paper.
No, Clement, you can't get out of it that way, I'm afraid. Jack, 32 seconds, the local post office, starting now.
It's all very well calling it the local post office, but if you happen to live nowhere near it, then it's not really local anymore, is it? And that's the point of contention that I brought up with my local post office, saying how dare you call it local when, in fact, it's miles away from my house. The bloke behind the counter was not impressed by that argument.
Paul challenge.
Did we have bloke behind the counter before?
Yes. And so, Paul, you've got him 15 seconds to go on the local post office starting now.
I remember my local post office very well back in the 1960s. They had this rather extraordinary way of organising queues. People would come in and be expected to stand behind one another. And this was an outrageous thing because you'd go up to the various little gates where people would be working behind and...
Lisa challenge.
People.
Yes. Standing one behind the other people.
Did I?
Yes.
Early, really early on.
Ah.
Really
I'm
early
trying,
on.
Baby.
In this show?
In this show, yes.
In this show.
It's always going to be people,
too,
this show.
Lisa, you've got him with 1 second to go.
Hey.
On the local post office, starting now.
Position 9,
Jack
please.
Charles. What was it?
I was just saying this counter's closed now.
Lisa, you have a point. You have 1 second. The local post office starting now.
Stamps are a very interesting thing to collect. Philately.
So, let me give you the situation as we're now moving into the final round in this show. Paul is still in the lead. He's 4 ahead of Jack D, who's done very well for a first-time player. Then comes Lisa Tarbuck, who has leapt forward in that last round, and she's just 1 ahead of Clement Freud as we go into the... Final round. Paul, we'd like you to start it. The subject is prehistoric woman.
60 seconds, starting now.
Prehistoric woman. We know very little about the creatures that lived before man evolved into Homo sapien, but prehistoric woman is something that we do actually have some information on.
Clement Challenge.
Some repetition some, of.
Yes, some.
Yeah, I've... Yes.
Clement, yeah. You've got in on prehistoric woman. You do have literal minds, don't you? And you have 48 seconds to tell us something about that experience, starting now.
It is no easy thing to get in on prehistoric woman. I'm not speaking from any experience, which I've had, because prehistoric woman has always been anti-post-historic man, which I consider myself to be. At school, prehistory, which is what prehistoric comes from, happened after geography and before trigonometry. I'm not sure why one did all those subjects in places where they said secondary education is our thing. Because take trigonometry. I mean, it is absolutely...
Jack, you pressed your buzzer.
Well, I think that was deviation, wasn't it?
Yes. And you've got away from prehistoric woman onto the educational system. You've got 11 seconds.
Bang
starting...
to rights, Clem.
Right, and you start now.
Prehistoric woman is something that I simply don't understand. To be honest, I don't understand prehistoric.
Paul Challenge.
Why?
Because you repeated understand.
Oh, yes, that. Yes.
That was it, wasn't it, Paul?
Repetition of I don't understand.
Yes. 5 seconds, Paul. Prehistoric woman starting now.
If we go back to the mists of time, to the Cro-Magnon period, we shall see...
Just a minute, Clement Challenge, what was that before?
Repetition of we in a very short term.
Yes, there were two we's.
I mean continent.
So, Clement, you have 2 seconds on prehistoric woman starting now.
Prehistoric woman starting now is something...
Paul, your challenge.
Well, there was a bit of a hesitation there, wasn't there?
No, there was no hesitation. He was building up a wonderful image for us all to go out on as we get into the finale of this show. And you've got... how can it go from 2 seconds to 6 seconds? It's never happened before.
Stephen Hawking in the building. We've just done something impossible.
So, no, it was an incorrect challenge, and the whistle started to go, and you got in before that. So, Clement, you have another point, and you have half a second. You have actually -6 seconds, but... half a second. Prehistoric woman starting now.
Just 66 seconds.
Well, I said that was to be the last round, and let me give you the final score, which is very fair, very close. Lisa Tarbuck, who came back and has triumphed because she's been so lovely with what she's done and said. But she did finish in fourth place, but a brilliant, absolutely brilliant fourth place, Lisa. And Clement was in a very strong third place, and just ahead of him was Jack D, who hasn't played before, remember, a powerful second place. Yes. But out in the lead, 4 points ahead, was Paul Merton. So we say, Paul, you are the winner this week. So it only remains for me to say thank you to these 4 fine players of the game. Paul Merton, Jack D, Lisa Tarbuck and Clement Freud. I thank Trudy Stevens, who's helped me with the score, blown her whistle with such aplomb. We're indebted to Ian Messiter, who created this amazing game. We're grateful to our producer, to Lucia Gilani, and to this lovely audience here in the Greenwich Theatre, who've cheered us on our way. From our audience, from me, Nicholas Parsons, and the panel, goodbye. Tune in the next time we play Just a Minute.
And next week, Nicholas will be joined by Paul Merton, Graham Norton, Tony Hawkes and Sue Perkins, all trying to speak for Just a Minute next Monday at 6:30.